Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Rural Affairs, Island and Natural Environment Committee in Session 6. And before we begin, can I remind members and those contributing to, if they're using electronic devices, to switch them to silent, please. Our first item of business is an introductory session on farming and crofting. And today I welcome to the meeting our first of our virtual remote panel members of industry stakeholders. We have Beatrice Morris, the Political Affairs Manager from NFUS Scotland, Professor David McCracken, Head of Integrated Land Management Department at Scotland's Rural College, Mike Robinson, the Co-Chair of Farming for 1.5 Inquiry, and Professor Sally Shortall, Member of Women in Agriculture Task Force. I'd like to all thank you for your briefings you provided with us. But before we move to members' questions, I'd like to first ask our panellists to make some very brief opening remarks. And I will request that you keep these remarks to no more than 2 minutes. I'd like to invite Beatrice Morris to make the opening remarks, and then move to Davy, Mike, and then Sally. So good morning.
Thank you very much for inviting NFU Scotland to participate in the panel this morning. We're absolutely delighted to have this opportunity. We represent 8,500 farmers and crofters across the length and breadth of Scotland. Our sector employs around 67,000 people, and we support numerous supply chain companies in both rural and urban areas in Scotland. To provide a bit of a flavour of NFU Scotland's work, we cover every sector of Scottish agriculture. We have over 300 work streams across our policy team. And what we're discussing today just provides a flavour in the headline of the issues that we're working on. So like other sectors, we're facing many challenges currently. We're issues in relation to the pandemic, impact of Brexit, and imminent changes to our future funding. In addition, the labour shortages and the very recent issue with fertiliser plants just shows the fragility of our food system and the vulnerability of our food security. It's never been a more important time to recognise and value Scottish food and farming. So as the work steps up to identify future funding for the sector, we very much believe that a holistic approach will be one that succeeds. Food production, tackling climate change, and enhancing biodiversity are all interlinked, and each of these strands are very important. To deliver our aims, we require both public funding and supporting regulation. We need policy that works and enables, and funding that's appropriate. We cannot achieve our climate change ambitions by exporting food production. We're absolutely committed to work with your committee, the Scottish Parliament and the governments to deliver a thriving farming sector. And this is important to continue food and drink production for our country and for our exports, alongside developing initiatives and actions to address climate change and crucially for our rural economies that are supported and enriched by our farming sector. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I move, beg your pardon, can I move on to Mike, please? Have I got the wrong order?
Hi, sorry. My name is Mike Robinson. I'm the co-chair of the Farming 1.5 Inquiry, along with Nigel Miller, who is the previous president of the NFUS. And the Farming 1.5 was very much an attempt to prevent duplication of effort in terms of how farming could meet its net zero requirements. It's very much written around what the industry needs to do, but we're trying to work out all of the different complex conundrums around employment and rural robustness and resilience, as well as, of course, biodiversity and meeting climate targets. We came up with a report with 15 major recommendations, which we think are a really important guide for the future of the industry, particularly post-2024. We're very concerned that obviously some of those actions need to start happening sooner rather than later. The real strength of this inquiry wasn't just that it was focused on what we need to do, but it was also the breadth of experience and expertise that we brought into the room, from economists to rural society, academics, to all sorts of farmers and others as well. So it's really the 15 recommendations that we're most interested in.
Thank you very much. And my apologies. Yeah, I did say we would go to Davy. So can we go to Davy now, please?
No worries. And thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. A common focus this morning will be the need to be clear about the outcomes desired before we seek to change policies and practice. And as we've already heard, there's a recognition of the continued importance of producing food while helping to address climate change and biodiversity declines. But we also need to recognise that we've failed over the last 30 years to deliver the scale of change needed to halt most biodiversity declines, let alone reverse them. And therefore, what we need, but do not seem to be seeing so far, is for biodiversity outcomes to be mainstreamed in the same way and at the same scale that climate actions are now starting to be. This will not only mean that broad biodiversity outcomes need to be given due consideration when developing greater environmental conditionality and future land management support payments, but also mean ensuring the availability of funding for more detailed targeted actions needed to produce biodiversity benefits where conditionality on its own is either insufficient or inappropriate. It will also mean debunking the myth that managing land for biodiversity outcomes only benefits wider society. If done appropriately, it can also increase the resilience of land management systems to climatic shocks. And managing land for biodiversity does not automatically imply that land management ceases. For many of the biodiversity outcomes we need to achieve in Scotland, it's really about getting the timing and the intensity of the management right, not stopping the management altogether. So one of the key issues the committee will face in this session will be how to ensure that biodiversity outcomes are included appropriately within the range of outcomes we need our land managers to deliver in the future. But a related and probably much broader key issue for the committee's consideration is not only how do we encourage the integrated land management needed, but just as importantly, how do we ensure that those integrated land management policies are also aligned with what we ultimately need our future food systems to deliver, both in terms of improving environmental and societal health in Scotland, but also future-proofing those systems against changes in external market demand. Trade-offs are inevitable, and we could go around in endless circles discussing the potential for these. But if we're clear on the outcomes desired from the start, then we can at least assess whether the expected positives from any change in policy or land management outweigh the perceived negatives. I look forward to the discussions with you this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Davey. And last but not least, Sally.
Here today. I'm here on behalf of the Women in Agriculture Task Force, which was established after some research I was involved in looking at the position of women in agriculture in Scotland. And the direct aim of that was to try and address some of the inequalities around women's role in agriculture. Women rarely inherit land, even though they're very active in the farm family. And they're very underrepresented in leadership positions in farming organisations. And women told us that they don't access the types of training that they should. The task force was established by Minister Ewing, and it was co-chaired by Joyce Campbell, a sheep farmer. And we met over a two-year period and came up with various recommendations to the Scottish Government around measures to improve women's representation in farming organisations and access to training and issues around new entrants and so on. Scotland has really led the way on this whole question of gender equality. The European Court of Auditors and DEFRA have kind of been following behind, so it will be really important to ensure that Scotland maintains that momentum. One item I would like to say is that I don't see the women in agriculture issue as an item on the agenda. I think women are part of the agricultural industry and have really important insights on how to achieve climate change targets, on how to achieve the sorts of goals around regenerative, sustainable agriculture that we're looking toward, on the implications of EU exit, and also on how to look at diversifying the different farm income streams. So I think it's really important that we see the whole question of women's role in agriculture as a wider one of the agricultural industry and commenting on all of the items on the agenda rather than just being one. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I very much appreciate you all keeping your opening statements brief, because we will certainly have plenty of questions. We've got a number of themes that we're going to explore, and I'll ask members to ask questions on that as we go through the next 80-odd minutes. I'm going to open up by one of probably the broadest questions that we're going to ask, and it relates to future agriculture and rural policy. We've heard that the government are planning to bring forward an agriculture bill by 2023. It seems a long way away, but we know that the guarantee on rural support payments is due to finish in 2023, at the start of 2023. We seem to be a long way from understanding what future policy is going to be. So can I ask the panel, and we'll start with Beatrice, what she believes the key requirements for any new agriculture and rural policy might be.
Thank you. Yep, we're absolutely delighted to be co-chairing the AREOB board alongside Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon. We need a portfolio of different policies and practices. There's no one silver bullet that we'll be able to deliver. What we need initially is to set up the pilot schemes quickly to identify what works. We need also to indicate and do some data as well, analysis, so that we can actually measure exactly where we are and where we need to get to. And we, as an organisation, are certainly participating in the consultation that's shutting in November with our members. It's very important that we're gathering the ideas there from them. But just to underline that the recommendations of the farmer-led groups that's already out there is a really good starting point. And what we're absolutely key about is that this group acts quickly. There aren't that many harvests left until 2045, so we need to get something started soon. So ultimately, my message today is that we need to deliver quickly.
Okay, and Davy.
Thank you. Beatrice has already indicated that we need a package of measures, and I think that's important. I think if we start only looking at one aspect of the whole support package, environmental conditionality, for example, on its own, and without knowing how it sits within the wider suite of measures. In my opening statement, I mentioned the need for conditionality for biodiversity benefits, but also an additional support funding for wider, more specific targeted biodiversity measures. And that's the same for whether it's biodiversity or whether it's support to wider agriculture, particularly with regard to less favoured area or area natural constraints. If we don't know what the overall package is, simply looking at one item on its own could result in quite a lot of unintended consequences. So it's been clear, and I think we are clear. We know what the needs are. We just need to make sure that the policy actually fits that. And both the Farming for 1.5 degree report and NFUS's and SRUC's recent report give some indication of what that combined package could be.
OK, and Mike?
Thank you. Again, I agree with a lot of that. Time is of the essence, absolutely. We need to make sure that what our priorities are in tackling all of this. I think we cannot achieve national climate targets without adopting this significantly within agriculture across the board. Biodiversity needs to be a part of that. So yes, absolutely, we need pilot schemes up and running. We need soil testing in place. We need to improve the advisory service, all these things. But in terms of the overall, yeah, we need to be as joined up as possible. So I agree with everybody else.
And Sally?
And again, I agree with everything that's been said. I think one of the issues that's come up in some work I've been doing with DEFRA is that farmers are aware that in terms of pursuing kind of issues around soil restoration, that there is a cost during that transition period. And they're very keen that there would be some kind of conversion payment to ensure that it remains economically viable for farmers to convert to meet the targets required. In terms of rural development, the agricultural subsidies are being phased out over a period of years, but the Rural Development Fund has just gone over a cliff. And this has real issues around stimulating farm diversification initiatives, which tend to be led by women. So I think that's something that really needs to be considered. What is going to replace that fund?
Okay, just generally, we've got another year, really. We're at the end of 2021 almost. We've got one more year, and it would appear that we still don't have a direction of travel with regards to policy. We've had consultation after consultation. We've got another consultation group. Elsewhere in the United Kingdom, we've had the principle of public good for public money in the public domain, if you like, for quite some time, but no such direction of travel in Scotland. I'm quite surprised there is not more of a message from you to suggest that we're running out of time to get these policies in place. You know, how long do we need to run these pilot schemes for before we can decide on policy? We had an announcement from the Minister that by November, which is only 6 weeks away, we would have policies to tackle emissions in agriculture, with absolutely no indication what those policies might be. Is there a bit of a lack of urgency? Beatrice?
Very pleased that the group has now started, and we were calling for that over the summer, that it was absolutely imperative that was implemented as soon as possible. And they have had our first meeting, and there's meetings fortnightly now, I believe, going forward. And there is an urgency to get going. You know, farmers are very keen to start on this route to change as well. And we're doing all we can and working all we can to implement. But the recommendations from the farmer-led group is there. So hopefully, you know, we can take them on board. We're not starting from a blank sheet of paper. There's a lot of work already been done that sets out some ideas already.
Okay, Mike, I think you wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, just to say that absolutely there's a lack of urgency, and we are sort of getting there, but it's a slow process. I think some of that is through duplication. I think we've really got to just do one thing and do it well. There is a tendency to keep reinventing the wheel, and I think we are going over some of the same ground again and again instead of actually bringing forward action. We do know what we need to do, particularly around climate change. I think we know what we need to do around biodiversity. We're just not quite doing it. So yes, absolutely, there's an urgency. There's a need to start actually implementing things as soon as possible, and not waiting for everything to come through in a bill in 3 years' time. It's too urgent to do that. We will have missed a third of the next decade if we're not careful. So.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to move to further supplementaries. I'm going to bring Ariane and then Rachel and Jim.
Thank you, Convener. So the bill that we're talking about is proposed to include, and I'm just going to direct this question actually to Mike. So the bill is proposed to include enhanced conditionality of support against public benefits with targeted outcomes for biodiversity gain and low emissions production. Do you agree with the Soil Association that the conditions for support should align with those in the EU farm to fork strategy, such as reducing chemical pesticides by 50% by 2030? And also be interested to know what other criteria you and others involved in the Farming for 1.5 inquiry would like to see included as conditions for subsidies. For example, should support be contingent on certain levels of carbon and methane reductions or use of agroecological practices that support nature to regenerate itself?
Thank you, Ariane. Short version is, do we think it should be conditional? Yes, absolutely. Conditionality is absolutely essential. We think that there needs to be targets against each of the greenhouse gases. There's no point just creating efficiencies, unit efficiencies, if we still go on to produce and emit more greenhouse gases. So we do need express limits around nitrogen, methane, carbon dioxide. We want a greening menu from 2022. We want general contracts, reduction contracts with farms. We want to see percentages of land committed to biodiversity. And we want all farms to sign up. So there's a lot of things there that we would like to see as sort of conditions.
Okay, would anybody else like to come in on that? TV.
Yes, thank you, and thanks for the question. Yeah, I mean, I agree wholeheartedly with what Mike had just said there. It's only through a level of conditionality are we going to get the scale of action needed for some of these sort of delivery mechanisms that we actually need. You know, I'm harking on about biodiversity. From a biodiversity perspective, we've had a scattergun approach over the last 30 years in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK and Europe that hasn't really worked. You know, for many of our biodiversity outcome needs, we need to have all farmers, or at least many farmers, actually working towards the sort of same goal, and some level of biodiversity conditionality and will achieve that. There's other aspects of biodiversity benefits. We'll need more specific, more targeted funding in a particular area, and most of that will need to be at a landscape scale. But your original question about environmental conditionality, yes, we need it. Yes, it needs to be mandatory. And actually, linking it back to the first question, we already know what we need to achieve. You know, the Farming and Food Production Future Policy Group, although that didn't produce a final report, the interim report is out there in the public domain. That not only sets the context for what we need to achieve and why, but it also sets the level of urgency of why we need to actually do that.
I'm going to go to Rachel, then Jim, and then Beatrice for further subs.
Thank you. It's to all the panel. So even if we change farming practices, we reduce livestock numbers and increase woodland planting, the scale across all sectors will not be enough. And it's reported that we will fall short by around about two-thirds of meeting those net zero targets. So what does the panel think that this means in terms of the recommendations of those climate group reports? What more needs to be done, and what impact will it have on farmers, consumers, and policymakers?
Beatrice, would you like to kick off?
Yeah, just to go back to the conditionality very quickly, we absolutely believe that it needs to, the conditions need to encourage active farming. So, and what we're very keen about as well is when you're looking at carbon emissions, that you look at carbon sequestration as well. I mean, there's a whole lot of work going on farms currently that is increasing the amount of carbon storage on farms as well. To take Rachel's question, as technology improves, you know, we believe that we will be able to make changes going forward. And I don't believe that we should look at just one aspect. It has to be a holistic thing of the whole farm. And you know, there's more precision farming going on. There's more regenerative farming going on. There's a lot of things going on there, and we're certainly wanting to start on that journey to help deliver it. And it's certainly something that we're committed to working towards.
Can I open up to the rest of the panel, please? Perhaps Mike.
Yes, thank you, Rachel. I think, obviously, nobody thinks this is going to be straightforward. Within the Farming 1.5 report, again, what we've tried to do is set out the stages that we think we need to go through here in order to achieve net zero. And obviously, they do start getting more difficult. Fundamentally, this can't be done without eventually fairly significant land use change. So it goes beyond purely farm agriculture and into the whole issue of land use change. And there are a number of areas that we do need to see starting to be adopted much more readily and relatively quickly. An obvious example being agroforestry. It's an area that's still contentious for different reasons, but there's absolutely a need to start to see that rolling forward. And I think what we're going to see is that over time, and maybe that's the emphasis of the bill, is that it's got to be about that sequenced change from measures we can adopt immediately, a list of actual greening measures that farms can take on board, the training and all the things that need to wrap around that. But ultimately, it's going to have to lead to land use change.
Davey, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, just again, and just to agree with Mike in particular, but also Beatrice. I mean, I'm unsure the package you put in the question, which would result in two-thirds, you know, failure by two-thirds of meeting the target. I mean, as Mike has emphasised and Beatrice has emphasised, precision farming, agricultural changes to agricultural practices will get us so far, but it's actually land use change and how we actually integrate that with our land management systems that will be the main route to actually get us to net zero. If your premise was, if we wait too long, we're not going to achieve it by 2045. That's correct. You know, we need to actually start changing those, encouraging, facilitating change to the agricultural practices now, but we also need to start encouraging, facilitating the change to the wider land management practices now as well. They're both equally important.
Okay, I've just got a quick supplementary before I bring Jim in. If agriculture or our land-based industries are going to struggle to get to net zero, we're not self-sufficient in red meat, so we import quite a percentage of our meats, whatever. Are we at the risk of reducing agricultural production, particularly in the red meat industry, to hit our targets in the UK, but we had unintended consequences that we then offshore beef and lamb production to areas where the carbon footprint is bigger, and ultimately, globally, it results in a slower transition to net zero. Has that been calculated within the plans going forward for plans for rural support and particularly agricultural production? Davey, and then we'll move to Sally.
Thanks. Well, again, just to say, I mean, there's elements of our red meat production in Scotland that are actually very vitally important for, you know, the production of other sort of outcomes, whether it's biodiversity or other what we call wider ecosystem services. So I don't see that we're potentially in danger of offshoring, as you've just said, depending on what type of possible knee-jerk reaction we might actually take. It comes back to looking at things in a whole, in the round. We can't just look at agriculture and agricultural practices in isolation. We need to actually instill that additional land management, land use change in association with agriculture and the other land uses out there. And you know, if we start that sooner rather than later and achieve it at the scale that we actually need to achieve it, I don't see that we're going to actually fall short, as both yourself and the previous question seem to imply. But it goes back to your question originally about urgency. We need to start it now. We should have started it 5-6 years ago. We need to start it now. 2045 is not long away. 2030 is even closer.
Thank you. Sally.
Just to come back to the previous question about how targets are going to be achieved, I would just like to underline Beatrice's point that she made. That, you know, science is developing all the time. I'm in this school of natural and environmental science, and scientists are working on this all of the time. So I think our tools to try and meet those targets will improve as time goes on. I think the question about the red meat sector is really important. And, you know, it might be worth consulting with colleagues in Northern Ireland, where it's going to be impossible for them to meet their targets because of their heavy reliance on being red meat producers. And they, I know, have been looking at what actually does it mean if they reduce red meat production, but then it's coming from somewhere further afield.
Thank you. Mike, a comment on this topic.
Obviously, there's no benefit in offshoring these emissions if that's all we manage to do by bringing in measures, but I don't think in this case, that's necessarily an issue. It's just one of these issues we've got to sort out in the way that we present the legislation and the way that we determine how this moves forward. Because that's true of any sector, obviously. It's no use if we simply shut down what we're doing and then just start importing worse, you know, more poorly produced products from abroad. We actually are self-sufficient in beef and lamb, so that isn't really necessarily a particular problem anyway in this particular instance. We already produce more beef and lamb than we consume domestically in Scotland. So we still need to make sure we take the measures. It's a bit like efficiencies. Just by being more efficient, if you're still producing more, it's not helping anybody. I hope that if we actually take the leadership on this and sufficiently put that into place, it actually might even be an advantage to us in the long run for exports and things. But in the first instance, I don't think there is a great risk of offshoring here because beef and lamb are already more than produced at the levels that we require domestically.
Thank you, Mike. Move on to Jim.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just actually like to pick up on that last point because both Rachel and Finlay have both talked about the reduction in livestock levels that we're aiming for. The Cabinet Secretary has already made quite clear that there is no plan to reduce the suckler cow numbers in the country, and I just think we need to get that on record. But I want to come back to the point that was made earlier on about the policy that we are currently looking to develop. In Scotland, the conditionality is going to be 50-50, whereas the UK scheme currently is all about public funds for public goods. Beatrice, this is probably more aimed at yourself. Given the fact that we see the farming community as being absolutely critical to us achieving our net zero target, I also think it's critical public goods are food production is regarded as a public good. We need to have food. We need to have a resilient food and drink sector in this country, and we need to have the primary producers producing that. So how do you think you're going to get the uptake of the farming community's enthusiasm for a policy? Is the 50-50 ratio one that you think is acceptable to the farming community? Because I know from my own point of view that farmers want to produce food, but they accept the fact that we need to do things differently. How do you feel that that's going to go down with the community?
Beatrice?
I think it's going to be a challenge, but it's certainly something that we at NFUS are absolutely committed to and working with our farmers to help them to deliver what needs to be delivered. Everybody accepts the fact that, you know, we're going to be helping to tackle climate change. We're in a great opportunity position with our land management used to enhance biodiversity as well. And it's going to be key going forward. And it's something that we at NFUS will work hard to ensure that our members are brought along the journey with us.
Well, can I ask you then, if we're looking at a 50-50 policy, do you think that it would be a harder sell to have a complete conditionality on public funds for public goods as it is in the UK, where there is no mention of food production at all?
I'm
not asking you to be political. I'm just asking you what's actually going to be able to... We want the farming community to go with this policy. We want them to embrace it. So is it going to be easier to get them to embrace a policy where they're still regarded as food producers, or will it be easier to get them to adopt a policy where it is simply regarded as, and I'm quoting, we're nothing but park keepers?
I don't know about that, Jim, I'm sorry, but I was at an event last week down in London, and you know the importance of food security, the importance of food production was certainly talked about very significantly down there. I mean, for us, producing food alongside tackling climate change and enhancing biodiversity is the three strands that we're going to be committed on taking forward, and that's something that we're keen to work on with Scottish Government and other stakeholders.
Okay, thank you.
Davy, you've indicated you'd like to come in on that, and then Mike, and then Sally.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Jim. No, I just wanted to reiterate, I intimated it in my opening statement. I mean, we need to actually get the wider agricultural industry to accept and recognise that delivering biodiversity benefits, taking action for climate change, is not just something they're doing for somebody else, for wider society. Many of the actions, if not all the actions that they're likely to be doing on their farms and land, will actually be beneficial to the future sustainability of those farming systems or the food production that they actually want to do. They are not immune from ongoing climate change at all, and many of the actions that they can put in place will actually help increase the resilience to that. And with regard to your question about the 50% versus 100%, then while I can appreciate why the rest of the UK or England is looking at a purely public funding for public goods perspective, the original premise of your question is how do you actually move farmers from the current situation to that without major disruption to the industry as a whole and food production, but also the associated management that's needed to actually deliver the climate change and biodiversity goals. I think the 50% goal is not an end point. It's a road on the journey, but it should be more acceptable to the vast majority of farmers if we actually ensure that they appreciate why it's of benefit to them to actually engage, and not just to wider society.
Thank you. And Mike?
Thank you, Convener. My sense is that there's a number of different issues that were sort of thrown up there by that set of questions. The first is, I suppose, I mean, my experience is that actually the farming community is more willing to act around this than ever before. And the crux of it is, how do we actually achieve what we all need to make happen and make sure that we still have a robust agricultural community beyond and helping to deliver that. So I do appreciate that there are short-term concerns around conditionality, I guess my question to you is, 50% conditionality reasonable or too much? Is why is 50% completely unconditional so reasonable, and why is that necessarily a really good idea? We've got major change needed here. We've got a willingness to act around this. I don't think we should be shy of making some of that conditional. In fact, all of it conditional. But we've just got to make sure that the way that we implement this makes sense and doesn't create victims and problems. But I think it's as much about how we do it as what we do. But the first question is, I'm not sure that 50% unconditional is particularly helpful. And I also think that that we've got to be careful that we're not ignoring the advice. The UKCCC's advice around livestock numbers was fairly clear. If we're trying to tackle climate change, we can't do it without land managers, without agriculture on board. We need to make it as easy as possible for them to help and get on board and do all the things that they need to do. And we need to try and back that and make that happen, not sort of just cherry pick the bits that we think will work.
Thank you. And Sally?
I think this is an excellent question, and research I've been doing in England suggests exactly that farmers do kind of feel they've been abandoned, that it has become an environmental policy. And this is one of the biggest, most fundamental changes in how agriculture has been conducted in decades. And I think it's really important to work with the farming community and to ensure that they have the business skills required for this transition. Because it may well be that having a combination of biodiversity and being food producers, but producing food in a different way, is a much more profitable way to farm. So it's about ensuring the business skills are there to maximise profit through this enormous change that's been expected of the sector. But government must support them through that and give them the tools to achieve the end point.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move to a question from Beatrice.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. I think some of my questions may already have been answered with the previous questions, but I was interested in the climate change and biodiversity loss and how we achieve that balance between the changes in land use and ensuring that farmers and crofters are still protected and able to do the job that they have to do. So how do we actually manage that? And Sally's touched on, you know, ensuring that there are business skills to manage changes. I'd be interested to know how we actually, the panel's views on how those changes are managed, particularly for crofters and farmers.
Who'd like to kick off? Beatrice?
Certainly by looking at things together. I've spoken to farmers who have done analysis on some of their cattle where the carbon emissions are less, but when you move over to a different field, the carbon emissions are slightly more, but the biodiversity increasing there is absolutely off the chart. So it's going to have to be looking at the whole farm together and not just one particular aspect of it. And, you know, I think that improvements do need to be made with regards to trying to assess biodiversity. It's not as easy, I don't believe. I'm not a scientist, but it's not as easy to assess biodiversity enhancement as it is to assess the carbon side of things. So I think improvements there might need to be made. And just looking at it from an overall perspective, it would be beneficial.
Thank you. And Davey?
Thank you. Just to work backwards from what Beatrice's fellow panel member said, actually, you know, biodiversity assessment is relatively easy as long as you're clear what aspect of biodiversity you want a particular farm or a particular farming system to actually achieve. And that leads me on to the main response was, while some aspects of what we want to want future farmers and crofters to provide are likely to be in common, you know, there'll be a need for all farmers and crofters to be doing something for soil health, because that's a common factor across all farming systems in Scotland. Dealing with water quality issues, Well, not exclusively, but will primarily be focused in on some aspects of our sort of our lowland agricultural areas, but not exclusively, as I said. But when it comes to biodiversity, while there might be some general gains from biodiversity to be made by all farmers doing a little of the same, actually it comes down to what do you want an upland farmer to do, or more importantly, what do you want an upland farmer or a crofter or an arable farmer? What do they need to do to improve biodiversity? And the elements that they will need to do will differ. It will differ because there's different opportunities in the uplands and in crofting systems, not exclusively, but it will be making sure that we've got the continuation of farm management practices that are still producing some of the biodiversity that we know and we want in Scotland going forward. In our lowlands and dairy and arable situations, it will be what else needs to be done on those farms to restore habitats to improve the biodiversity and that can actually occur on those farms.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to ask Ariane for a supplementary on this, and then as we're discussing around the topic, we're going to move to links with land use for a question from Jenny. But Ariane, we'd like to come in with your supplementary.
Thanks. Yeah, just briefly. So I think Mike earlier you mentioned agroforestry, and you know I'm hearing that agroforestry is going to be a big important part. But you mentioned that there were tensions related to agroforestry, and I wonder if you could unpack that a little bit for us.
Thank you. Yes. I mean, it's really just that there's not a clear framework for promoting agroforestry. And I know that within farms, there's anxieties about its practicability on the farm, particularly in terms of getting in the way of machinery. And so there, it's a practice, even though it's a traditional practice, and you know, we've had agroforestry for many, many years. We've really not seen a lot of it in recent times. So there's a resistance to its adoption because it's seen as unhelpful for other wider farming practices. But Beatrice may have thoughts about its adoption. I don't think we've currently got a system in place that encourages it very well, supports it very well, or promotes it sufficiently.
Thank you. Beatrice, would you like to come in on that?
You know, I'm new to the sector, and one thing that I just want to absolutely underline is that, you know, it's not about forestry or farming. It's something that we're absolutely key about, that we believe that, you know, that they can both work alongside each other. And one of the things that we're looking at is what we're hoping for farmers to be more enabled to introduce woodland alongside food production. There's been great examples of that already happening, where they can create wildlife corridors, where they can provide, once the trees are a certain height, shaded grazing for livestock, etc. And I think it's really important that we are supportive of the Scottish Government's woodland creation, but it can't be to the detriment of farmland, and that we need to work together and all collaborate in order for that to work alongside food production. And certainly something that we are hoping for is for farmers to be better enabled to introduce and stitch it within their land already. And that's something that we're keen to take forward.
Okay, thank you. And Davey.
Thank you. So Beatrice and Mike have already talked about the detail of what I would have said in terms of the need to promote agroforestry more. I just want to make the observation that agroforestry, regenerative agriculture, many of the terms that we're using in this session and in discussions about, you know, future support policies, they're all quite broad. They mean different things to different people. We need to be clearer what we mean by agroforestry in this case, and what agroforestry might mean to one farmer will be completely different to what agroforestry might mean to another, in terms of what's relevant for them to actually produce, put into their farm, integrate into their farm in order to actually achieve benefits from it. We need to be clearer on what we're actually asking for.
Okay, can I move to Jenny?
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for joining us today. Kind of moves on from what you were just saying there, Davey, about the impact of having forestry on different farms and how that impacts on the farms that haven't got the forestry, for example. So most of the panel have commented on whole farm farming, and I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on whole community farming and how you see the regional land use partnerships and frameworks supporting active farming. And also, if I can, I represent a West Coast constituency with islands as well, and I'm interested to know, to get your thoughts on how a just transition works for the different types of farming that are across Scotland as well. Thank you. I don't know, Davy, do you want to go? Do you want to go first?
Yes, sorry. So there was a lot in that question, or a lot of questions in that question.
Yes, sorry.
You might need to remind me of the. You might need to remind me of latter aspects if I forget that there. First of all, going back to what I just said before, you know, we talk about wanting to put more forestry into farms. We don't. We need to put more trees, woodlands, and where relevant, forests into farms. So again, terminology, you know, is highly important there. In terms of actually, I think you, the tenor of your question was asking about how do we get more community engagement in putting woodland into a landscape?
Yes, that's right. And looking across the whole area, not looking at it, I suppose, farm by farm.
Ah, right. Okay. Well, certainly, then that will come down to whatever that whole area, be it a catchment, part of a catchment, whatever you're considering, being clear, as I've said earlier, about what are the outcomes you actually want from putting sort of more trees and woodland into that, and what does that mean for what type of trees and woodland that's relevant to put in, and then the engagement with the land managers, and be they farmers, be they local communities that have access to land, to actually have a discussion and an agreement as to what's feasible going forward. And that's not just feasible in terms of are they willing to do it, it's also feasibility in terms of are they able to access the funds, the support, the guidance that allows them to actually do that. You also mentioned the new regional land use partnerships and their role in that. Then certainly they could have a potential role in that. At the minute, I would say, despite the fact that we're in our third land use strategy, the regional land use partnerships have literally just started. I'm not familiar with them, with all five of them, the vast majority, if not all five of them, they have vast areas to actually cover within the pilot area. And I would imagine a question for each of them will be, what are we going to target where, and look at within each of those. So, unfortunately, regional land use partnerships, I think it's early days to see whether they're going to be able to have a success with that. And certainly whether they're going to be able to address all of the issues, all of the land management change issues that we need going forward. But your question was about woodland, and I would have thought woodland and more woodland creation and management at a wider landscape level involving communities and land managers, I would have thought that could be one of the easiest wins. But it depends on the individual, it depends on the area, it depends on how much trees, woodland and forestry is already there, and what both the land managers and their and the rural communities' attitudes are to already are or perceived attitudes already are to woodlands and forests. I work all over the country. I know there's quite a lot of adverse reaction among some communities down in the southwest, where we already have very high proportion of woodlands and forests in the landscape. And again, so it will depend on the region, the area, and what type of woodland and trees you're looking to try and enhance and facilitate. And I think there was a final part to your question, but I'm afraid I've forgotten that one.
I asked about transition. What does a just transition look like for West Coast and island farmers?
I don't think a just transition necessarily looks much different from West Coast and Island farmers than for the rest of Scottish agriculture, with the exception that we have to take into account the additional constraints that they're under in terms of transport on and off the island, cost of imports onto the island for their agricultural practices, or for if you're wanting to create woodland in some of those islands, those trees have got to come from somewhere, and it's highly unlikely that they'll actually have been produced somewhere in a similar island environment, and you need to make sure that the trees that they're sourcing come and have been produced in an environment that will enhance their ability to actually establish and grow. So there are some island-specific issues that need to be taken into account, but I think if we get the overall just transition approach to agriculture in place, we can then try and then work on the additional nuances that might need to be put in place for particular sectors and for particular communities. And you've used islands as an example, but there'll be other equally remote rural areas of Scotland where there'll be possibly even less aspect to transport links to the rest of Scotland.
Thank you, David. Before I bring Mike in, you touched on regional land use partnerships, but I'm a bit confused, and it would appear that you're not quite certain what the outcomes of these regional land use partnerships should be either. What are going to be the measures of success or otherwise of these pilots? You touched on whether policies need to apply to a particular farmer, a particular sector, or a farming system. And you mentioned the south of Scotland, where we've already got a lot of trees, but we've also got the milk fields of Scotland are in the southwest, and we've also got a very important circular cow sector. We've also got some world important peatlands and etc. So what's your measure of whether these land use partnerships are successful or not? What are actually the outcomes expected to be, and how are they going to feed into future rural agriculture and rural policy? So I'm going to ask you that question, but I'll also bring Mike in on the same to address Jenny's questions.
So in principle, the focus of having a regional, we're calling it a regional land use partnership in this instance, a fora to bring different land managers and stakeholders together to actually discuss land use change for a particular area, a particular region, is appropriate. My query about how much the regional land use partnerships can actually achieve in this first phase is based on two premises. One, they've literally just started. Two, part of this first phase is to do exactly that for each of the regions, to try and establish what might be the best approach to take in this particular region. And three, you may want to, in later sessions of the committee, investigator question whether the regional land use partnerships have been supported enough in terms of funding directed to them for this first phase to allow them to investigate that in particular. So the reason I said all of them I would expect might have to in this first phase focus solely on one particular region within the wider pilot area is I don't believe they've been given sufficient funding nor capacity to actually test the regional land use partnership to the full extent of the geographical areas of the pilot areas that have been established.
Does that help, Finlay? Yep, that's. Thank you for that. Can I bring in Mike on the same questions, and then I'll bring in Beatrice Morris.
Again, I'll try and do my best to answer the questions. And apologies if I'm a bit throaty. I'm at home with COVID today. So land use change sequestration need to reflect soil type, topography, the production and biodiversity priorities for the farmer, the locality, and also the targets for Scotland as a whole. So for me, regional land use partnerships are a really important delivery tool in all of this. And as such, their membership must reflect the local community, including land managers, farmers, crofters, but also have roots in all other community activities and an eye on the national priorities. Obviously, there's a lot of things that might mark that success. I think membership is a very easy measure of that success and that diversity, but also the sort of we need to map the potential of each region to be able to deliver against these national priorities as well. For me, obviously, the percentage of greenhouse gas reductions and the biodiversity improvements that are made are very obvious and key measures. In the Farming 1.5, we talked about 30% of land being given over to nature. In terms of the Just Transition Commission, the biggest single thing I think is just in terms of reskilling. There is a need for more farmers. We've got a huge skills deficit potentially around some of this knowledge. And for me, that's an area I think that needs to be prioritised. There's a slight onus on Just Transition towards the oil sector, and we need to make sure that the rural communities don't miss out.
Thank you. And Beatrice, and then we'll come in with a supplementary from Jenny.
Just to underline, absolutely agree with what Mike has just said there. Farmers need to be part of the rural land use partnerships. We don't operate in isolation. 72% of the land in Scotland is under agricultural management, and it's absolutely imperative that we're part of these discussions. You know, if you look at the way that farms impact on the rural economy, I visited a farm a couple of weeks ago, and they'd calculated that they use 92 supply chain companies, the majority of which were in a five mile radius of their farm. So we need to take into consideration the business of food production when decisions are being taken about land use in areas, certainly. So we would like to be a key part of them. There's some concern in some areas where the pilots are starting up that there's not that much information and collaboration. And so it's something that we certainly want to increase with going forward.
Okay, and Sally, and then I'll move to Beatrice. No, Sally, if you could come in and address Jenny's questions, and then I'll go to Mercedes.
It goes for the religious glow about me. My blind is broken at my office, so there's nothing I can do about it. Just to say that I think there are gaps in our knowledge, and I know that a lot of my colleagues are involved in different projects called Treescapes, working with colleagues in Scotland, where they're looking to try and understand the types of questions that you've asked around what will be the role of the community, how do farmers interact with all of that, what are the appropriate kind of trees for different areas, and what quantity. So I think it's important to recognise there are questions we don't necessarily have the answers to, but there are people working on it. And if I could just come back to an earlier question about biodiversity and crafting, I think that's a really important one in terms of public goods and ensuring funding for public goods. And there is also a gender dimension to that, because women are almost twice as much represented in crafting as they are in farming more generally in Scotland.
Thank you. And I'll move to questions from Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. Just while we're on the topic of land use and management, and thinking about we're seeing, I think, a reduction in farmers and ageing population, and many potential new farmers are priced out of starting up because of the cost of land. And I know in the recent programme for government, there's commitments to modernise tenant farming and to reform smallholding legislation. And so I was just interested to hear from the panel if there's any particular measures that you'd like to see to make it easier for potential new producers starting out, and to really put power into their hands, into the hands of people that are going to be working the land.
Kick off with Sally and then move to Beatrice.
I think that's a really interesting question. And one of the issues that we see time and time again, that one of the bottlenecks in achieving a more innovative type of farming is the intergenerational transfer of land. So you see, and it's usually men, who are farming the way the farm was farmed six generations ago, which is no longer, you know, in tune with the kind of climate targets we have and the types of objectives we want to reach. So the whole question of new entrants and regenerating the farming sector is really important. And I think that whole question of actually bringing in new blood, because we see that time and time again, when one of the really important contributions women make in the farm is when they marry in, they're actually bringing a whole new perspective. They're questioning why it is done like that and leading to different and better practices through their role in decision making. It's a difficult one to crack because it hinges on private property and people's rights to do what they want with private property. There are some interesting examples from Ireland of share farming, where you see older farmers working with new incoming farmers in partnership and giving them scope to be more innovative. I think there's also ways of thinking about leasing or making machinery more available, and also, you know, innovative ways of making livestock more available. Maybe they rent livestock, keep the offspring, because what you're seeing is a kind of two-tier agricultural sector where the inheriting son has far less cost than the tenant farmer coming in. And the tenant farmers, the new entrants we interviewed in Scotland, were by far and away the most innovative, cutting edge, undertaking the types of farming initiatives that you really want them to be. And often they were working full time to have the income to put back into the farm, and they were still continuing to be really innovative and forward thinking.
Thank you. And Beatrice Morris.
I mean, the difficulty in securing tenancies just now is absolutely key for young people. You know, I've met young farmers who are on what's called contract farming, so it's like 364 days of a tenancy, which means that the investment isn't possible to make. You know, they can't secure loans. It's, you know, that's very short-term viewpoint of it. So that certainly does need to be addressed. You know, attracting new entrants into the workforce is absolutely key, and certainly work does need to be done there. I know that we're, you know, it's not just securing people to come in and own the farms and long-term wise, we're also struggling to attract workers in as well. And there's been a lot of coverage about shortage of seasonal workers, but permanent workers as well is very difficult to secure just now. And that's something that we're looking to address and identifying shortages and identifying where the pinch points are. But it's the whole workforce issue that does need addressed, and we're keen to work with people to help facilitate that.
Thank you. And before we move on from land use, Rachel Hamilton's got a brief supplementary.
It was just to go back to Jen's question about forestry. We know that in Scotland, forestry targets have not been met, and the government have no intention of bringing in any new forestry grant funding schemes before 2024. So the question is, do you think that if farmers were incentivised to have support through new forestry grant schemes to have the right trees in the right place at the right time, that actually we could get on and start to meet these net zero targets quicker? Davy.
Yes. Sorry, the short answer, excuse me a second. Apologies. And the short answer to your question is yes, but I would argue that there are already existing incentives for farmers to actually integrate more trees and woodlands onto their farms at the scale that they might feel comfortable with in the short instance. It's just the current, they exist in the current woodland grant schemes. It's just that those type of entry creations are not the ones that are currently being prioritised by those that are seeking to actually put in larger areas of woodland and forest. In the goal of chasing those individual annual targets for new establishment. So yes, I think more could be done to actually develop additional complementary schemes to help and encourage farmers to take them up. But there's also more that could be done to actually help facilitate them and see the relevance of some of the schemes that already exist.
Okay, and Mike?
If I may just answer that and a little bit on the previous question. The first is, I think that a factor that we felt within the inquiry team was that this slightly fell between stools. It wasn't quite the forestry department, it wasn't quite agriculture, and I think that meant it wasn't really getting the focus that it could and the emphasis that it could. I wanted also just very quickly to answer the previous question about the need for new farmers, and there's absolutely a need for a lot of new blood. It's no different to any other industry. A lot of young people are voting with their feet, and I think a very strong and real commitment to these issues around climate change and biodiversity would actually attract a lot more people into this sector. And yes, there absolutely are issues to do with access to land, but a really important factor here as well is the image that's portrayed of the industry. And I think that grasping these appropriate targets and tackling them head on is actually a very, very positive thing for young people right now.
Thank you very much. We'll now move on to questions on the impact of EU exit in relation to agriculture from Alistair.
Thank you very much, Convener. As you've mentioned, I'm interested in your take on what's been happening post-Brexit, and particularly I know that the NFUS has had things to say about trade deals. So a question perhaps for Beatrice, perhaps for Davy McCracken as well, about whether you have any views or concerns about what future trade deals might look like for farming.
Beatrice, would you like to start?
No problem. Our concerns about the Australian trade deal are very well publicised over June. We are very concerned that the Statutory Trade and Agricultural Commission has not yet been established. You know, we've been told that the establishment of it's going is imminent, but we absolutely need that to be up and running in order to analyse and provide advice on the possible impacts of the trade deals on agriculture. So it's absolutely the number one ask that we have, is that set up straight away. The other thing that we absolutely need more of is better effective consultation with the agricultural sector across Scotland with regards to the trade deals. When we're talking to our Australian counterparts, our New Zealand counterparts, it's very clear that they are much more involved around the table at an earlier stage, and that's something that we're absolutely key about. We're often told that when we're concerned about the unrestricted trade, that we should be more ambitious, that we should, you know, look out to be exporting more. In order for us to do that, we need more investment in the processing capacity sector within the country, and that's absolutely key. What's concerning for us is that the cumulative impact of trade deal after trade deal with unrestricted access, that is going to impact the farming sector, which will have a negative impact on our rural communities.
Does Davy McCracken or others have a view on that?
Davy.
So thank you. So I'm not best placed to provide any detailed thought on trade deals per se, or the impact of those. What I did include in my written submission was an indication, a suggestion that we should be also paying proper attention in Scotland to what are we looking to trade in the future. You know, we're looking at developing our agricultural support policies, our land management support policies, potentially divorced or in isolation from our sort of our food and future food system support policies. It's not my area of expertise. It's colleagues elsewhere in SRIUC dealing with food policy. They have insight, and other countries in the EU are looking quite closely to actually amalgamate their land management support policies with their future food support policies to ensure that they are trying to future-proof their agricultural systems to be moving, to be producing the type of agricultural goods that the external market, if trade deals allow, the external market are likely to actually demand. And that will change. It is changing for Scotland as well as the rest of the world. So, as I say, not specific to the intricacies of the trade deals, because that's not my area of expertise, but just a suggestion that seeing agricultural support in the wider sphere of what type of food systems, food policies do we want to actually have in Scotland? How much of that actually is going to help address some of the food-related issues that we actually have in Scotland, and make sure that we future-proof our future farming systems to be producing the type of goods that could be traded elsewhere?
Do you really think, Professor McCracken, that the impetus behind the trade deals has anything to do with the issues you've just mentioned?
My personal view is no. But that is, you know, as I say, I'm not a trade deal expert. I'm just trying to step back and see what the wider context we also need to take into account. It's one thing taking a trade deal to produce, to provide markets for goods we're already producing. I'm just saying we won't necessarily be needing trade deals to provide markets for those same goods in 10, 15, 20 years' time. There'll be other goods we want to ensure can enter that marketplace.
Thank you. Can I ask again, perhaps Beatrice, to begin with, what your feeling is about the implications of the UK Internal Market Act when it comes, again, thinking particularly here of imports from outside the UK, and what it means for Scotland's ability to legislate in that area.
Explain.
I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I mean, I think obviously you have concerns about the quality of what might be imported, particularly in terms of meat in the future. So I suppose what I'm asking is, does legislation like the UK Internal Market Act give you any concern about Scotland's ability to offer any kind of legislation that would restrict imports that would be unhelpful to the Scottish industry?
I mean, standards for us are absolutely key, and we're renowned for our high quality standards around the world, and we don't want any changes to, we don't want any products coming into the country that will have less high standards than we currently produce here. We're absolutely key for that. We need to have the ability for Scotland to make changes or to be flexible with regards to our agricultural policy. The common frameworks that are in place that are aiming to maintain the internal market are important. The internal market is an important market for Scottish agriculture, but we do need to maintain that flexibility there for Scotland to be able to tweak things in order for the benefit of our agricultural sector up here.
And do others have any view on that? Again, I'm not sure whether that... I see a hand up from Sally Shortall.
I just wanted to say that in terms of... I completely agree with Beatrice that in terms of international trade and new trade agreements, that you need to consult with farmers and producers. And I would just urge that you're mindful of gender representation when you're doing that. Because the point is, you have to have women involved in farms at the top table so that they can influence the types of decisions that are being made. And following a report from the European Court of Auditors, DG Agri are starting to take this more seriously and are aware that in having consulted with representatives of farmers' unions through COPA and COEGA, they have really been developing trade deals and agreements with men. So it's just very important, I think, for the efficiency of the industry and the benefit of the sector, that we ensure that there is a gender balance at the top table of these trade agreements.
On that, I think many women in agriculture would agree with what you've just said about women being excluded from these deals. Do you feel Scotland has been excluded from these deals as well?
I mean, it's the same question as, you know, arises for Northern Ireland as for Scotland. It's very difficult when there are different views of what EU exit should look like and trade deals, and that has to be negotiated within a UK internal market and common framework context. So it's very difficult.
Finally, can I ask about a subject that one or two people have touched on, and again, it's related to the aftermath of Brexit, and that's around labour shortages. I don't know if anyone wants to put up their hand and indicate who wants to come in on that, but clearly there's a connection between the two things. Again, perhaps begin with Beatrice.
You received evidence a couple of weeks ago talking about the labour shortage within the food and drink sector. And just to mirror what I said earlier on, that it's more than just Brexit. We've had problems accessing permanent staff for some time now, which we're looking to address long term. What we need is short-term action to help what's currently going on just now. We've had soft fruit farmers, for example, who last year struggled to secure staff because of the pandemic. This year, the issues have compounded that, and they're now looking towards next year. No action has been taken, despite the fact that they are struggling to get seasonal workers over. So they're now thinking of changing, you know, commodity. They're thinking of moving away from soft fruit, and that would be absolutely catastrophic. Soft fruit takes up 1% of the agriculture of the land mass, but it delivers 16% of the economic output. And so we need to have action now. The seasonal workers pilot programme needs to be reviewed. were absolutely key for that. But we need we are calling alongside Food and Drink Federation and Scotland Food and Drink, as they were a few weeks ago to you, for this 12-month COVID visa. I think it's a perfect storm just now that all these issues, Brexit, the pandemic, you know, longer term workforce issues, they're all adding into a situation where our members are losing money, they're losing crops, they're not being able to be picked up by HGV drivers, they're not being able to harvest them. And it's very serious. It's something that's very serious. And without immediate action being taken by, and we're talking to the Home Office about this, you know, the message is getting through, well, this isn't going to go away anytime soon. So decisions are being taken about next year already.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Jim in a second of supplementing this. Beatrice, I want to direct this to you as well. You suggested that the NFUS were concerned about the Australia deal. I would like you to elaborate on that a little bit more, given that there, as far as I understand, there's bilateral safeguard mechanisms to ensure that there's a safety net for industries if they do face serious consequences from an increase in imports. And it does seem fairly unlikely we're going to see a big increase in imports from Australia. There's also existing deals or policies regarding the fear about importing lower food of a lower food standards. And it's clear that the manifesto and all the trade negotiations that the UK government will not compromise on environmental protection or animal welfare or food standards. So where exactly do your concerns come from? Could you elaborate a little bit more?
Certainly. So, yes, there are some short-term reassurances that have been included within the trade deal, but they are short-term. I think the figures, I don't have them to hand, but they do rise up rather significantly over the next, you know, 5, 8, 10 years. That's the cumulative impact that we are majorly concerned about. So the Australian trade deal has effectively paved the way for unrestricted trade. New Zealand is due imminently. You know, we're assuming that it will be very similar to the Australian trade deal with regards to what's been agreed there. So it's that trade deal after trade deal and the impact that we're concerned over our agricultural sector. With regard to the standards, As far as I understand, and I may be wrong about this, but it's the standards with regards to, you know, if you're standing looking at a supermarket shelf and there's beef from Scotland or beef from Australia, it'll be clear where they came from and the standards are going to be the same. What I think is more difficult is when it's a processed product coming into the country, and, you know, how the standards of that will be able to be guaranteed and assured. I'm not quite sure that that's absolutely 100% as simple to do.
Okay, it'd be interesting. Maybe you could write to the committee and give us an indication of what volumes of beef and produce is likely to come in. That would certainly give us a good indication of where to address your concerns. And Jim, would you like to come in with a supplementary?
Yes, very quickly. Beatrice, have you had any response from the UK government with your request for a one-year COVID visa to allow us to fill that short-term or that gap in the workplace across the food and drink sector?
Not yet. No, we haven't. And that's certainly concerning our members because, you know, we've asked for a specific action to be taken. There's been no indication that's going to be delivered. And so that's why there's some serious concern about what their options are for future years going forward.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions again from Jim on profitability and resilience in the sector?
Thank you, Convener. You caught me out there. Profitability and resilience in the sector, it's a very loaded question, because you've got so many different sectors, and profitability and resilience will be different across each individual sector. But David, I'm going to come to you first because I specifically want to look at hill and upland farming and where the profitability and resilience are going to come from. We've touched quite a lot already on you called it planting trees, which I'm glad you did, rather than just forestry, because I'd like to try and see if we can get away from this conflict between trees versus farming, there has to be a way to integrate both of them together. I can see real opportunities for us developing a timber industry that farmers could actually be a part of. There's bound to be jobs there that can be created out of a timber industry. We can also be using timber, I think, rather than having sheds, maybe having woodland. So I'd like to just explore some of that and how that's going to tie in to make sure we have profitability and resilience in the upland sector at the moment.
Yep, so as you hinted in your question, our upland farmers aren't profitable at the minute without subsidy, and even with that support, many of them are struggling to actually get over the sort of red into the black. You've indicated one element that will be important going forward. It's what other direct income generation products can they actually have on their land, and integrating woodland, trees and woodland much more into upland farms, we believe very strongly is one route and will be an essential route to consider. And we've talked earlier on in the discussion about whether the incentives are there or promoted enough to allow them to do that. I would also add that, you know, our hills and uplands are highly important for a wide variety of other reasons. And, you know, I've been talking a lot over the last few years about how our upland farmers, or wider society in Scotland, will be looking to our upland farmers not only to produce food products, not only to produce timber products and possibly even different type of timber products in the future, but also to manage water quantity. You know, flooding and flood mitigation will be a very important activity for our upland farmers to actually produce or provide in the future. What we don't have at the minute, we do have capital grants to allow those that have got peatlands on their land, degraded peatlands, to actually restore those peatlands. But what we don't have yet is any ongoing annual recognition, financial payment, a payment for public goods, payment for ecosystem services that will actually reward our upland farmers for doing that. So I do see that there is a lot of opportunities for upland farmers going forward to increase their income streams to more than. But some of those markets don't yet exist in terms of being able to provide them with the financial reward for doing so. And that is a big question for not just our agricultural policy, but our wider public support in Scotland going forward.
Thank you. And Mike?
Yes, I think it really just comes back down to conditionality. We want to see farmers rewarded for looking after soil carbon, soil regeneration, biodiversity, flood alleviation, all of these other ecosystem services, as we say, that are public goods that go beyond just the physical production. And we need to just start to reflect that. I think this is the opportunity to allow us to do that. In terms of referencing previously, very quickly, the sort of trade deals issue, there's an opportunity in trade deals. We don't want to see climate change and biodiversity targets that we're imposing domestically abandoned in order to make sure that we get trade deals. So we should be using the trade deals to project high standards and drive globally the things that we're doing and build our reputation internationally for that, because I think it isn't just about. I think it becomes an important.
Sorry, Mike. We've lost you. Beatrice, can I ask you to come in the back of this until we can see if Mike's connection settles down?
Certainly. We've talked about labour shortages, we've talked about processing shortages as well. We need regulation that enables. I absolutely agree with what Mike was saying there in this. Enabling farmers to do more with regards to climate change and to biodiversity and avoiding unintended consequences as well. I mean, that's absolutely key. One thing that we haven't touched on yet is the local supply side of things, and that again goes back to the processing, and that needs investment in order for that to be delivered. But we're certainly keen to work with stakeholders and aim to increase the profitability of farms alongside the environmental work that we'll be doing as well.
Thank you. Can I bring in Sally and then we'll move to Davy?
But I was involved in some research with the Scottish Government where they were trying to develop legislation around migrants. And what I found really interesting was how progressive it was, because the starting point was how to protect the human rights of a vulnerable group of workers. And, you know, it will be interesting to see how much scope you have to develop your own legislation around that. In terms of profitability, excuse me, and resilience in the sector, again, it's about looking at the whole farm family activities and, you know, being cognizant of the types of diversification and entrepreneurial activities that are developed on farm and often are led by women. So it's looking at how to resource that, subsidise it, and ensure that there's sufficient training about it. The other thing we found is that women have a greater understanding of the kind of food to fork chain and are quite imaginative about, as Beatrice was talking about, kind of that kind of community production, which can also be a means of increasing profit. I mean, it's one kind of part of the overall jigsaw, but I think it's an important one. Thank you.
Thank you. And briefly, Davy.
Thank you. And I will be brief. Jim's question was primarily about upland systems, and I just wanted to come in. Although conditionality on direct payments or future payments in whatever form will be important, I don't believe for our upland systems that only taking a conditionality route will provide enough funding into those systems to make them profitable. That's why I highlighted earlier on about the need for additional funding for these additional public goods, these additional public benefits that are much more complex to actually help deliver.
David, can you just clarify, do you mean getting support into these farms that are already doing the things that they've been asked to do over the last number of years, that has continued, that you continue to recognise that?
That's part of it. What I was primarily meaning was, if you were thinking of let's put more conditionality on the level of direct support that's currently going to upland farming systems, then that's not going to be enough to make the change. You would need to bring the LFAS, which sits separately, into that wider package going into upland systems and improve the conditionality onto that. But actually, just the type of outcomes we need, what you can achieve via conditionality is not going to be enough to recognise support and reward them for the additional management that they will need to do beyond conditionality to achieve those wider outcomes. And it's a bigger question. I would argue very strongly that we should be supporting those individuals and systems as much who are already delivering those goods, rather than just actually setting the clock now and only providing recognition and reward to those individuals that start to produce them now. That would be inherently unfair and unjust.
Thank you. I'll now move to Rachel Hamilton and Karen to ask some questions on women in agriculture.
I'd like to start off by asking Beatrice how the NFUS encourages women into leadership positions in its organisation.
Have we got Beatrice? Yep.
Sorry. We're very supportive and we've been very active in women in agriculture since day one. Our former president, Andrew McCormack, chaired a working group, and we're opened up our membership to family membership now, which recognises that there's a lot of family businesses, but often the partnership between people in a family and playing incredibly important roles within the farms. We've seen a growth in the number of women participating in our branch, regional and board level. We're trying to improve cultural change, and we're doing what we can to promote it. We're very supportive of Women in Agriculture Task Force certainly do what we can to support the events and networks that they're doing. There's still more to be done, but they're certainly moving in the right direction.
Thank you. Can I go to Sally? The Scottish Government want to legislate to ensure equal rights of succession for women in agriculture. The Women in Agriculture report in 2019 looked at areas of barriers for women coming into agriculture, such as childcare responsibilities, access to land, finance, training and education. And I just wondered if you believed that legislation would drive the change that you're seeking, or for the reasons that I've given in terms of the barriers, that those need to be addressed first.
So there is actually no legal barrier to women inheriting land. There is nothing in the legislation that says that women cannot. The barrier is a cultural one. It's that farming is understood as a male occupation. When parents are looking at the successor, they look at the boys. You know, when we were doing the research, we interviewed one young woman who was the eldest of four girls. And she told me that when she was 13 and her brother was born, she knew she would no longer inherit the family farm. And she subsequently went on to rent land with her partner when they were both working full time. And she was working in the agricultural sector and brought that knowledge to the farm she rented. But the barrier there wasn't a legal one, it was a cultural one. The country in Europe that has legislated around this is Norway. Back in 1974, they introduced the allodial law, where they made the eldest child the legal heir to the farm. Now, you can argue there's inequalities in that too. But actually, in terms of gender representation, it's had minimal impact. So it's not legislation, it's tackling the culture around these issues that need to be addressed. And the Scottish Government, I think, is doing quite a lot of work around that. So, you know, the previous question about what is the position of women in leadership roles, that's really important in terms of the message that it sends out. Where are women in the sector? Where are they at the top table? The task force has recommended an unconscious gender bias training has taken place. Men we interviewed said they would not vote for women to have a position in farming organisations. Women told us, and we've seen reports of it subsequently in newspapers, that at a certain point they're asked to leave farming meetings because the social part is finished and the business part is about to begin. So there's multiple kind of approaches that are needed around succession planning, pointing out the talent that's in there, ensuring that women are represented in the industry. And I think that also requires being mindful that when positions on executive boards are being replaced, that there is an onus on the agriculture and food industry to ensure a gender representation when they are appointing new board members. So it has to be a kind of multi-pronged attack approach. I agree that the whole question of new entrants is a real issue, and a particular one for women because of the difficulties they have accessing land.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Mike and Dave if they believe that it's not only difficult for women to get into agriculture, but it's also difficult for new entrants, for young people, and for farming to have a diverse representation. But do you believe that the net zero targets will actually draw in a new group of people through different interests such as innovation, and we will see a sea change in the number of representation across the board in agriculture?
Move to Davey.
Yep, thank you. So, I mean, first of all, just to set a bit of context, I'm only responsible for one part of the SRUC, but, you know, within our Upland Research Centre, our Hillmount Research Centre, six of the seven members of staff are all female, and all three of our existing PhD students are female. I have a wider suite of teams, and two of the four teams are led by females, and also include female lecturers. For me, it's not the agriculture side of things that's important. I'm not responsible for our wider agricultural courses, but there's good female representation, both in terms of the sort of the leadership and the lecturership roles within those, but also within the students within that. For my area of SRUC, my issue with representation, both in terms of staff and but also in terms of students coming in, is in the forestry area. You know, I have a forestry team that's dominated, well, solely male, and I have students, candidates coming forward to those forestry education and training needs that are 98% male, and that is something that we do want to change and we do need to change. And you've hit the nail on the head in terms of the wider skill sets that we actually need within Scotland and elsewhere, but within Scotland in terms of the green recovery from pandemic, will draw on both a wider set of skills and a wider set of knowledge and understanding. But also, we need to crack this perception that work in rural industries, farming and forestry, is only for brawny males. You know, we mentioned precision agriculture earlier. Technology and the range of skill sets that we're actually looking for. I think our wildlife and conservation management course that's led by a female colleague, I think it's dominated by female candidates. So there will be more of the way of opening up. But I think I would have come in at one of the earlier questions. We need to actually have a more of a consideration right from school in Scotland that these type of employment in rural industries, A, are different than what the school pupils, their teachers and likely their parents may actually think. But also, whether it's farming, whether it's forestry, whether it's wildlife and conservation management, whether it's sustainable land use, will actually need to involve a greater range of sort of technologies and metrics which should be open to all and are open to all. It's just we're not instilling enough knowledge and information and interest and female candidates come forward into some of those courses, but we will be working actively to change that. And not only do I hope that change, that needs to actually change. As Sally and Beatrice have already said, you know, and I know from the experience of working with women colleagues, managing women colleagues, they bring a different mindset, a different approach, and possibly a much more collegiate and less competitive approach to actually trying to make important decisions about areas of conflict.
Thank you. Before I bring anybody else in the panel, and I'm going to move to Karen for her questions, and then we can address all the questions at that point. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Directed to Sally, you spoke a lot about the role of women play in diversifying within the sector. And I was able to visit a farm that's diversifying into agritourism along with their working farm. And the women farmer was highlighting her farming practices, and they've been really incredibly successful, being environmentally aware, reusing and recycling materials to make camping pods, for example, educating people on the farm, as well as supporting local economy. And it really ticked so many boxes, so to speak. And this is one example where I note the pragmatic approach of the woman really took off when she was given that pathway and support to do this. And I just really want to ask, is the gendered lens of the sector you're using really helping to open up that often untapped potential and entrepreneurship of women in the sector? And, you know, could you explain how you feel that the work you've done will enhance the whole sector and not just the women?
Question, and I would be very disappointed if anybody thought our work is simply about enhancing the position of women rather than the whole agricultural sector. And we were very clear about that both in the research and the task force report. Excuse me, I hope I haven't caught the COVID, but I seem to have a tickle in my throat. The whole point is that bringing women in is beneficial for the agricultural industry. You know, you don't one of my colleagues said, you don't leave half your team on the bench. So this is much better for the agricultural industry. I'll give you an example of an upland farm where a woman married in kept asking why they were doing things the way they were doing. They were milking, losing money, hand over fist. Her partner was suffering with his mental health. And she completely changed the type of farming they were doing, took them into environmental schemes, changed to native breeds. And farming communities to change the breaking rank with how the farm has always been farmed. But she turned a farm that was unprofitable into one that is now profitable. And that's not, she would not talk about herself as a woman. She would be talking about the type of changes she introduced into that farm and how the agricultural sector needs to come at things differently. There needs to be much better business skills, because she could see that in the farm, they were not operating as a business. And that's difficult when you are a family. You know, when it's your siblings or your parents, you don't think we need to sit down and have a business meeting. So everything tends to get done on the back of a fag packet. But a fresh pair of eyes coming in can see that more clearly. And that is very much what it's about. And I think that's the important point. There has been this enormous untapped potential that I think is people are suddenly starting to see, and it's really important that we tap that. But I think it's also really important that we recognise that it's there. So, you know, I would agree with Davey, there's some good representation in agricultural training and courses. If you look at a lot of the admin people in NFUS, you will see a lot of women who didn't inherit the farm, but went into farm-related employment as advisors and so on. But the key question is who's at the top table making decisions, negotiating trade agreements, deciding on the appropriate subsidies, making decisions about the future of the farm. And that has to be everybody active in the family farm. Thank you.
Thank you. That's certainly something we'll take away. Leaving some of your best players on the bench, I think, is a very good point when it comes to women in agriculture. That's a good point to finish on that question. Just very finally and very briefly, we have touched on budget and touched on LFAS and so on, but we've really got seismic shift coming for farming and rural areas when it comes to the challenges ahead. Can I ask whether the panellists, and I say very briefly, believe that we need additional budget to bring forward these policies, to pump prime new projects, and given that we hear so much about the health benefits of better biodiversity and the environment we live in, and land managers, farmers, whatever, got a big part to play in it, do you reckon that we need an increased budget for this sector, and do you think your arguments for it will be listened to, and we will see that delivered in the future? Can I start with Sally, Beatrice, Davey, and then finish with Mike, please?
I'm sorry, I missed half that question. I just my sound went low. Do you mind repeating it?
Yes, certainly. We're going to see seismic shift in the rural areas with agriculture policy, with biodiversity and so on going forward. Do we need to see an increase in budget to help deliver that?
I think the key thing where budget will really need to be invested is in business skills. You know, we're asking farm families to embrace a completely different way of being and acting. And I think it's really important that we work with them to provide the skills that they need, whether that's farm consultancy, whether it's short-term training. All of that will need investment, and I don't think we can expect farm families to be paying for that. So for me, at the practical level, I think there's going to be budget needed for that.
Thank you. Beatrice?
What we're asking for is the certainty of ring-fenced funding and multi-annual funding commitment that at least matches current levels. That's what we're calling for.
OK, thank you. Davy and then Mike.
And before asking for more, Beatrice has hinted at there, you know, we need to start from what we have and make sure or look to see how it can be best utilised. Clearly, though, as we've highlighted through the session, a greater proportion of that spend, it doesn't necessarily need to be additional spend, but a greater proportion of that spend needs to go in sort of biodiversity and wider environmental management. But we also need to have some consideration. We're entering a new world. How much of our support to land management going forward needs to actually come in the form of an annual payment for something, and how much, as Sally was indicating, would actually, how much could be achieved, as Sally was indicating, by one-off pump priming, payments, training, access to capital grant, whatever, that allows them to move from one plane to another, that allows them on that individual farm business or land management business to be much more sustainable in its own right moving forward.
Thank you. And finally, Mike.
Thank you. I think basically what we're doing at the moment, but I think so it's got to be driven around this need for change. This industry has a huge opportunity to be seen as much more progressive and to actually take action that the whole of Scotland needs. I think it probably needs a short-term injection to help with that shift. I think that's essential. But otherwise, it's got to move. And I think that's probably around training and all sorts of other issues and helping deliver what we've presented in the Farming 1.5 inquiry.
Great. That brings us to the end of the session. Can I thank you very much for your contributions this morning? They've been very welcome and it'll help inform our business, our work programme going forward. So thank you all very much. I'm now going to briefly suspend until 10:50 to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back, everybody. And our second panel, I'd like to welcome Stephen Young, Head of Policy of Scottish Land and Estates, Christopher Nicholson, Chairman of the Scottish Tenants Farmers Association, Pete Ritchie, the Chair of Scottish Environmental Link, Food and Farming Group, Donald McKinnon, Chair of the Scottish Crofting Federation, and Miranda Gleehood, Scotland Policy and Campaigns Coordinator for the Land Workers Alliance. Once again, can I ask you to make a very brief opening statement? If you could keep your comments to about 2 minutes, that would be very helpful. I'll invite Stephen Young to make the opening remarks, and then move to Christopher, Pete, Donald, then Miranda. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. Thank you again for the opportunity to speak to you today. Just a little bit of background. The Scottish Land and Estates, we're a membership organisation. We have land managers from all parts of Scotland, both large and small scale, everything in between, and all types of land ownership model, from private owners, NGOs. Our members are involved in all aspects of rural business, which gives us a fairly unique take on rural development. So we're covering all areas, not simply agriculture, but everything else. We've long talked about, due to that, taking an integrated approach to land management. Today, obviously, we're talking about agriculture mainly, but the impacts that agriculture has on all land use need to be understood. And they're all interconnected. Changes to one make changes to others, so they have to work together. I think within land management, there are pressures coming from many different sides. And we're being asked, like every sector, to reduce emissions. We're looking to increase sequestration. We're looking to increase biodiversity. We've been asked to produce affordable nutrition. We have to maintain the rural economy. And we provide wellbeing services for society as a whole. Now, I'm not sure there's any other sector that's been asked to achieve all these things simultaneously in a short period of time. All of them can be achieved, and I think land management can play a role in all of these things, but support is desperately needed to do that. Support itself is not simply just financial support, but also knowledge and understanding, the training and the skills to deliver these things, and whole supply chain approaches, understanding what impacts the market has on these other elements, and where resilience can be built in, whether it's a market return, whether it is government support, or where we can do that. The other area that within knowledge transfer is understanding the win-wins, understanding where support is not needed. What are the areas that we can make changes in which have benefits both economically and environmentally, and they can almost take care of themselves? So they need to be understood by all, and we need to have a better understanding of where we're all trying to go in the future. Once we have that very clearly laid out, have their policies in place, then I believe we can deliver all of the things that we're looking to.
Thank you. And move to Christopher.
Thank you. On behalf of the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to give evidence to your committee today, looking at the challenges ahead for Scottish agriculture. The tenants that we represent tend to be the smaller to medium-sized family farms, often farming concentrated in the more marginal farming areas, and with a tenancy at the core of their family business. They don't enjoy the benefits that come with land ownership. So these are the types of farms that are facing the greatest uncertainties as resulting from Brexit, greening, and the adoption of new farm policy. In contrast to owner-occupied farms, it's difficult to see how tenants, currently limited by restrictive agricultural leases, can benefit from future policy measures which focus on carbon and greening without first there being changes to existing tenancy legislation. Furthermore, the new interest in land from green capital is resulting in the removal of tenant farmers to be replaced by mainly commercial forestry and other greening measures like rewilding. So our ask is that tenancy legislation is amended to allow fair access to carbon and greening related measures for tenants, And the new farm policy that we're likely to see in this parliament is feasibility tested for the tenanted sector. Bert Fergus Ewing, the previous cabinet secretary, promised that there'd be a level playing field between tenants and owner-occupiers for access to these future measures, and that tenants would be able to play their part in climate mitigation and increasing biodiversity, etc. However, there's two to get there and not much time to do it in. So those are the points I'd like to make to start with. Thank you.
Thank you, Christopher. We'll move to Pete.
Thank you, and thanks for inviting Scottish Environment Link to give evidence. I chair the Food and Farming Group, and what we want to particularly emphasise is the value of taking the camera back a little bit in this conversation. As people have said, the Agricultural Bill is due to come in 23, and there's lots of work going on at the moment to look at some of the mechanics and the objectives of that. But we also know that the Good Food Nation Bill will be introduced and possibly sooner than that. And we think it's vital as Link Food and Farming Group that these two things are tied up together. We are the food and farming group. And the Good Food Nation Bill should set a framework for food policy across all the areas, environment, climate change, consumption, production, use of natural resources, waste. And that framework, I think, will shape what we then want to pay farmers to do and how farmers can contribute to that vision of a good food nation. And they have an absolute essential role. There's no food without farming. And all the discussions we've had earlier about imports and exports and the islands, and rural areas, small farms, women, are all part of that mix. So what we want to do is to emphasise the need for policy coherence, joined up policy making between food and farming, and make sure that when we think about farming, what we support farmers to do, we can help farmers have a prosperous, sustainable future. That has to be part of how we do food in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Pete. And Donald.
Thank you, Convener. I'm Donald McKinnon, a crofter from the Isle of Lewis and chair of the Scottish Crofting Federation. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to give evidence today. SCF represents just under 2,000 members from across the crofting counties and is the only organisation solely dedicated to representing crofters and crofting. Crofting brings numerous benefits to the Highlands and Islands and to Scotland as a whole. It is part of the solution to the climate emergency, the biodiversity crisis, and reversing depopulation in these areas. But it will only fulfil this potential with appropriate agricultural support and legislation that works for crofters and crofting. On agricultural support, we need to see clarity now on the future direction of the support system. That system needs to take a holistic approach, reducing carbon emissions, promoting biodiversity, and recognise the socio-economic impact of support. The system needs to reward and encourage existing good practice, as well as incentivising change where required. On legislation, we were very disappointed that the programme for government for this year did not include reference to any intention to deliver crofting law reform. SCF has continually warned that if a crofting bill is to be delivered in this parliamentary session, then work needs to start on that now. The market in crofts is completely out of control, with local young people in particular completely priced out. This situation is not sustainable, and we need to start working towards a long-term solution to this and other legislative issues. Thank you for the opportunity to contribute.
Thank you, Donald. And finally, Miranda.
Thank you very much, and good morning. My name is Miranda Geelt. I'm here representing the Land Workers Alliance. We are a union of farmers, growers, crofters, foresters, and other land-based workers. As we are still relatively new to Scotland, I feel the need for a bit of an introduction. We have an active membership stretching as far north as Shetland and as far south as Dumfries and Galloway. Most of our members work at smaller scales. They include crofts and small holdings, market gardens, and community projects. But we also increasingly have medium-sized and actually larger farms joining us, which combine a variety of activities from horticulture to arable and from livestock to agroforestry. What binds us together ultimately is that we all believe in agroecology, a term that also was used earlier this morning. So farming with nature and with people, looking to support both and use the land to benefit both. And we support an integrated approach to farming as well as an integrated approach to agricultural and food policies. There are a lot of things on the agenda today that are of great interest to our members, like agricultural subsidies, climate and biodiversity measures, and anything around what a just transition could look like, but also more implicit topics around land ownership and access, new entrant support, and local supply change. So thank you very much for having me here today, and I'm looking forward to your questions.
Thank you, and I appreciate you all keeping your introductions brief, but you're all very welcome. I'm going to kick off with the first questions on future agriculture and rural policies and EU exit in relation to agriculture. So very broadly, can I ask each of you in turn what your key requirements will be for the new agriculture and rural policy that will be brought forward to this Parliament before 2023, and what the impact of EU exit will have in that future policy. And can I start with Stephen, please?
Yes, thank you. I mean, the key elements, like I said before, is that integrated approach to land management, understanding how different industries fit together. For too long, we've kind of seen issues between forestry and agriculture. How do we make them work together to get, it's a cliche, but the right activity in the right place at the right time. And while we're doing that, we have to maintain a critical mass in terms of food production and agricultural production, maintaining value within Scotland and adding value where we can to maximise returns to the farm gate. So really, where we need to start with the policies, what are the clear aims we've got, and then work down as to where we want to go. The farmer-led groups have made a good start. The concern is there that they are purely looking at agriculture, and actually what we've done is divide sectors within agriculture as well, and there is a danger that we then get competition between sectors, and that could make things worse. And hopefully the area will sort that out and all work together in terms of just making sure there's diversity of thought amongst that as well. In terms of the new policy, I think in terms of support, I think I mentioned before as well that support doesn't have to be simply kind of cash payments. Knowledge transfer, having the Farm Advisory Service, which is strong and there to help people develop their businesses, capital funding to put in place. A lot of the measures we're going to need to meet the kind of climate change objectives, and also a really clear long-term view. You know, rural businesses have long life cycles. We can't just have 90-degree turns every few years. We have to have long, sustained goals. And looking at the work so far, and all of the farmer-led groups, things like biodiversity scorecards, the conditionality around environmental payments, I think these are all positive steps in the right direction. Just getting them right and making them fit for purpose, but also achieving our goals so they're workable at ground level, but also meet the kind of national targets will be huge, hugely important. But all sectors need to move forward together, and that's everything. You know, as I say, it's forestry, it's peatland, it's agriculture. We have to move forward together, because if we get out of step, then it causes huge issues for businesses planning for the future.
Thank you. Christopher.
You has raised all sorts of uncertainties for Scottish agriculture. What does future policy look like? Issues around labour supply. That has got a potential shortage of labour and access to labour potentially has might have greater effect on Scottish agriculture than other issues like policy. Then we've got we don't fully understand the impact of the free trade agreements that have been agreed or in the process of negotiation. They might be free trade agreements, but how fair are they for Scottish producers that may be producing at a disadvantage in more difficult circumstances than other countries? I think in the past, looking to the future, was clear that certainly for the uplands and more marginal lands, we're looking at much greater integrated land use in the future. We need to look at how the relationship between forestry and agriculture can work. And we know from past experience of the last decade or two that where we've considered, looked at individual rural issues in their own silos, they've had a lot of unintended consequences, often negative consequences on sectors. So I agree with those who say that we should be looking at this more holistically and not considering individual enterprises in their own silos. I also think in terms of, we're up against quite a time limit to not just design policy, but to see it being, see good farmer uptake and understanding of it. And I think we have to be careful, or the policymakers have to be careful, that new policy is presented in a framework and language that farmers understand, and that access to it and application procedures are fair and open and easily understood for all in the rural sector.
Thank you, Christopher. Peter, please.
First of all, we need the new policy to be completely clear-eyed about what it is we're supporting farmers to do. The current policy is about as it could be. It's detached from any impact on practice. It's deadweight money at the moment, and it's inequitable. Most of the money goes to the biggest farmers on the best land. So it's not clear at all what the current system is designed to achieve. And we need to be absolutely clear with the new system that we're aligning farm support with climate and nature objectives, as well as good quality food production and nourishing the people of Scotland. So we have to be dead clear on the purpose. And then we have to be really rigorous about how are the instruments that we're developing going to achieve that purpose. We have to probably have a anti-payment evaluation, some modelling of that, some clear work, which I think hasn't been done as well in DEFRA as it might have been, in terms of what are we trying to achieve here with public support for farming. So that's the first thing. And then within that, we think there needs to be a clear pivot to agroecology, as Miranda mentioned earlier, combining farming and nature, not putting farming in one box and nature in another box, and a pivot to local. We've seen a huge interest in the pandemic in stronger local food economies, and there's a huge role here for strengthening local food economies and for strengthening horticulture, particularly small and medium-scale horticulture, the glasshouse sector, etc. And finally, we want to stay aligned with the EU. The EU is bringing the Sustainable Food Law in 2023, which will provide a sort of overall framework for food policy in the EU following the Farm to Fork initiative, and that will frame the future CAP in Europe. So if we're going to stay aligned to Europe, we need to have this overall framework of food law, but also link what we support farmers to do to really clear policy objectives. Thank you.
Thank you. But just on that, there's an awful lot in that contribution. Do we have time to do it all before we see a bill go through the process and become an act by 2023? Are we already too late? Pete, specifically on your contribution?
No, we're certainly not too late. We have to get a wiggle on, and we need to have a process which is inclusive, which I think the new process is panning out to be, but which is evidence-based. We have to have clear, transparent modelling of what it is we're trying to achieve with these subsidies. The current subsidy system broadly inflates the price of land. That's its main impact on the basic payments. And there are small subsidies around the edge of that, which are constructive, like the new entrants. We've lost the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme for the time being, or most of it. We need to get that back into place in the short term. But in the longer term, we need a farm support system that's designed fit for purpose. And as other people have said, as Stephen said, that is fit for 20, 25, 30 years. It can't be a scheme that we set up and then we change after 5 years. So we need to put our best efforts into this. But we also need to look around the world at how other countries are tackling climate nature emergencies through the way they're changing their farm support. And we need to make sure that there's always going to be politics in this thing. There's always going to be winners and losers. But the important thing is we're transparent about that. And as Donald says, we've got to make sure that we include farmers at all scales and sizes, whether they're part-time farmers, full-time farmers, women farmers, urban farmers. the framework for support has to be inclusive of all of those. But we've got time to do it.
Thank you. Donald, and then Miranda, on those thoughts.
Thanks. As I mentioned in my opening remarks there, I think this policy has to achieve a lot. The three points that I mentioned in my opening remarks there around reducing carbon emissions and tackling the biodiversity crisis and the recognising the socioeconomic impact of support, I think those are all very important. I would also add to that the importance of that the policy aims to encourage active farming and crofting and active use of the land, and also that it's linked in with food and food production. I think there is a danger that is a lot that's trying to be achieved, and that that quite rightly reducing carbon emissions is top of the agenda, I would say, from a policy perspective, but there is a danger that we could focus on that at the exclusion of some of these other really important outcomes that can't be overlooked. At an actual scheme level, I think it's essential that any schemes that are developed following on from that policy are accessible to smaller producers, in particular crofters, and that they take recognition of crofters' common grazings, which are a fairly unique system that can't be just shoehorned into any old scheme. I think that it's also really important that Pete mentioned there about agri-environment schemes, that agri-environment schemes too are accessible to the vast majority of producers in the country. At the moment, their competitive nature has meant that we're not getting enough land into those agri-environment schemes, and that's something that has to be a priority going forward. Thanks.
Okay, Donald, and Miranda, finally.
Yes, thank you. Yes, we very much agree that future agricultural and rural payments should very much be re-centered around the objectives to protect biodiversity, address climate change, but also to provide greater equity. And in this regard, I fully agree with Pete. It needs to be said that area-based payments in themselves are problematic. We are still paying for the size of land in question, even if we condition those payments on better management. I think we need to wrap our heads around the fact that good things can be done in small spaces. Give an example, some economic analysis has been done on one of our members' crofts, which combines small-scale livestock production with horticulture, estimating that he is generating about £42,000 annually in public benefits, be it environmental, being in terms of employment, other community benefits. But he's only receiving £1,200 in subsidies because he is a small-scale farmer. So I think there isn't enough talk about overhaul of payments altogether, and I understand the politics behind it, but I think that is something that needs to be said. And yes, if we keep the basic payments, there are a number of examples to give of things that we definitely should be doing, whether it's to keep the quite low minimum area requirement, 3 hectares here in Scotland, as opposed to 5 hectares in England, has been quite positive. We also should be taking some inspiration from what's happening in the EU. They have now introduced mandatory redistributive payments, which give more money to the first few hectares of a farm. And yes, we should look at the accessibility of agri-environmental schemes for everyone. But ultimately, I think we should be starting at really looking at the objectives of what we are trying to achieve.
Thank you. I'm now going to bring Alistair Allen in.
Thank you very much, Convener. Question probably for both Donald and Miranda, given both of their interest in crofting. I suspect the clock is against this, Convener, so I'm going to ask two questions together. One is about legislation and the other is not about legislation. So in terms of the issue of legislation, you've mentioned, Donald, and I think many people would agree with you, that the need for for legislation around crofting. The crofting law sump is one place to begin, but you also mentioned there the issue of the cost of taking on a tenancy being out of control. So my first question is, do you feel that there should be a reassessment of what is meant in law by the improvements on a croft in order to prevent such tenancy assignations, the cost of them getting out of control? The question I had that's not about legislation is about the effectiveness, in your view, of the arrangements that we've got for dealing with crofts that are not so much absentee crofters, because people can, I know, sublet and otherwise make use of crofts, but crofts which are abandoned or derelict, and whether you feel that the Crofting Commission could do more to intervene in those situations.
Donald, do you want to kick off, and then we'll go to Miranda?
Thanks for the question, Alistair. I think on the first point around legislation, I think we had the crofting law stump is a good place to start on this. I think it identifies a lot of the major, perhaps the technical issues in the existing legislation that need to be sorted out to allow crofting to, the law as it exists at the moment, to work effectively. I think we're getting to a point where there's a realisation that that might not be enough. And certainly what was proposed in the last parliamentary session, which was a phase one and a phase two approach, that phase one bill wouldn't go anywhere near some of these more fundamental issues, I think, that are being raised more recently, certainly in the last year or so. On your point about specific point about improvements, whether that's a route to tackling this issue, I'm not quite sure if it is. I think it's something that's maybe needs to be looked at and considered. And I'm certainly not here to say exactly what needs to change in the legislation. But fundamentally, what the issue at the moment is that the price of a croft that a croft can change hands for is not regulated in any way at all, and the transfer of owner-occupied crofts is not regulated at all. At least with the tenancies, there is an element of regulation there, but price does not come into it. How you actually bring forward legislation which deals with that issue is I'm not saying that is easy in any way, shape, or form. But we need to start having these conversations now about what the options are, and gain the views of the wider sector on what people actually want to see, because I do believe that we are approaching some sort of consensus around this. I think that will in itself take time, but I think there is a lot of agreement out there in the crofting community. On your other point about how you can solve some of these issues around neglect of croft land within the current system, I think it's been very encouraging to see the steps that the Crofting Commission have taken through additional support, additional funding to employ development officers in the Western Isles to start with as a pilot scheme. I think that a lot of these issues at a basic level could be solved by through education and through Crofting Commission staff actually on the ground being able to speak to individual crofters about how they could sort out their situation, because I do believe that most people do want to do the right thing. And there are just certain barriers in the way to doing that. I don't think that will be enough either. I think there probably is a place for the Crofting Commission to enforce its regulations that it exists to do. I do think that will require additional resources to the Crofting Commission, which I think would give them the opportunity to do more in that area, because I think there is a willingness on the behalf of the Commission to do that. I think that they are just struggling to get to that part of their work, and that's certainly the understanding I received from them. I hope that answers both of your questions, Alistair.
Thank you, Miranda.
Thank you. Yes, I will not add too much to Donald's analysis of the crossing legislation and the issues around some of specific requirements. What I would want to add is that, as to your second point, to inactive crofts, that issue goes beyond crofting, but the issue is slightly different. Obviously, for all its weaknesses, crofting comes with an added layer of protection that you cannot, in principle, decroft unless there are stipulations met. Whereas that kind of protection does not apply to small holdings, which are often situated towards the south, or not always. And that means in that case, there's actually a real risk that some of these small holdings just simply cease to exist. They are sold often, more often than not, they are sold separately. The houses are sold separately from the land. And yes, this adds to this big problem of there already being a real need for land. There's a lot of people actually wanting to go into farming, and in particular small-scale farming, that are struggling to find land, to find affordable land, to find suitable houses to go with the land. And yes, this.
Thank you. Just on the sort of top we're now touching on it, agricultural tenancies, whatever, I'll ask Jenny and then Mercedes to ask some questions on that topic.
Great, thank you, and thank you, panel. I think this is a question really directed at Christopher Nicholson. I'm interested to know what level of contact the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association has had with the Scottish Government in relation to the needs of tenant farmers in relation to future agricultural policy. And also, if you could expand a bit more on one of your opening remarks about what the just transition would look like for tenant farmers.
I think there's a strong awareness amongst policymakers, the civil servants and Scottish Government, and also, importantly, the Scottish Lands Commission and the Tenant Farming Commissioner, as to what is needed. And we've had a lot of contact with the Lands Commission over this in the last few years. And also previously with Fergus Ewing, and we have had meetings and communications with the current Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon as to what the needs are for the tenanted sector to allow tenants to play their part in climate change and increasing biodiversity, etc. So barriers are well known. I think there are ideas there as to solutions. I know the Tenant Farming Commissioner, Bob McIntosh, has produced a paper looking at the barriers and fixes available or that might be needed for tenants to play their part in tree planting, and quite extensive tree planting. And I think that was as a result of a request from Fergus Ewing to look at how tenants can plant more trees. Now, his barriers that are identified and the fixes that are required to allow tenants to plant trees are pretty similar to the barriers that exist and the fixes that are required for tenants to play their part in wider greening measures and climate change measures. So really, I think it is quite well understood. It's just a case of getting on and making the changes.
Okay, thank you. And I thought it was quite interesting you referenced the Scottish Land Commission there, and I noticed that Andrew Thin made some comments about pressures of farmers and crofters are facing over carbon rights and more widely on tenant farmers' access to climate change measures. Can you expand a wee bit on that, please?
Well, the element that's impacting on tenants is the new financial interest there is in acquiring land for greening measures, whether that's carbon credits. At the moment, what we're seeing the most of is forestry, followed by rewilding, where areas are being removed from the tenanted sector. Tenants, they might be secure tenants, and their landlords are doing deals with them to resume parts of their lease, or where they're non-secure tenants on limited duration tenancies, then those leases are not being renewed. And it's more attractive now for some landlords to sell land to sell land with vacant possession without tenants to these new sources of green finance that we're seeing, whether that be pension funds, private equity, or industry, industries looking for future carbon offsets. That is focused on the more marginal lands, where typical of livestock grazing farmland, and the main impact we're seeing is that it's in some cases doubling the value of land. That means that where tenants are offered the opportunity to buy their farms, landlords are looking at not agricultural values but forestry values, and that is unaffordable for tenants. So I think this new source of green funding looking to acquire chunks of Scotland is a similar problem I think Wales is experiencing as well, because they have large areas of marginal land. It's really reversing some of the aims of land reform in Scotland. It's not increasing diversity of ownership. It's doing the opposite, concentrating ownership. And often it's not looking at wider integrated land uses. It's very focused on carbon at the expense of the environment and other land uses, as you see by, especially in the south of Scotland, from South Ayrshire across to the borders, huge areas of commercial Sitka spruce being planted, and often it's tenants who bear the brunt of it.
Thank you. Donald and Stephen would like to come in. So Donald first, then Stephen.
Thanks. I just wanted to come in there on the point about carbon credits and Andrew Thin's comments from the Scottish Land Commission. I think this is an increasing concern for crofters as well as for tenants. There is a real, I think, a lack of understanding about where this is heading at the moment, and it's heading forward at a rate of knots, with a real lack of clarity on who these carbon credits belong to, who is actually entitled to trade them in the future, and for crofters, this is particularly in relation to peatlands and peatland restoration. Something that crofters have already been taking forward on their common grazings. So I think it's an issue that I would agree with the comments that Andrew Thin made in that statement, that there should be a pause on this until there is greater clarity. And I think it's a topic that this committee should pay close attention to as these things move forward. Thanks.
Thank you. And Stephen.
I agree with Christopher and Donald there that it is complex. I think this speaks back to the need to integrate different land management kind of sectors. You know, land use change is a key part of the land use strategy, but the climate change plan, you know, how does that sit? Are we running counter to that when we're looking at agriculture purely? In terms of Andrew Thin's comments on pausing, I think that's a difficult area, because it's not that easy to pause. If we're going to meet the climate change targets that we have, then we can't just put things on hold for too long. It is an opportunity to bring money into rural areas. What I would say as well is that, you know, in terms of carbon credits, the Woodland Carbon Code and the Peatland Code don't just get given a carbon credit for owning the land. It's a result of active management, so you have to have done something. You have to physically plant a tree, restore peatland, and in both of those schemes you have to prove that they wouldn't have been cost effective to do that work without the money you were likely to get from the carbon credit. So it's a theory of additionality. So there is something there that says, you know, this is part of kind of risk and reward. I know Andrew's comment, and I take on board the element of we don't know in future whether we're going to be asked to be carbon neutral as a business individually or as a sector. But I think in terms of agriculture and rural business, it's always about risk. Everything you do incurs risk, and there'll be reward. And particularly some of these elements, there's a long time fees, for example. You know, it's a long time till they are cash generating in themselves, so it can pump prime there. As with anything as well, it's probably not wise to sell everything on day one. It's probably wise to hedge your bets a little bit. But it's all about understanding that risk, and in running any business incurs risk, and people can make that decision as long as they have the information in front of them. But what I would say in terms of pausing is that if anyone is planting trees or restoring peatland, even if you don't sell the credits now, they have to get on and register them so that they can sell them later if they want to, or they can be dealt with. If we stop or we don't do that now, then we're stocking up problems for later on. So I think we need to be really clear what we're trying to achieve here, both in terms of climate change, agriculture, land use, but also in what messages we're sending out to people and how they can achieve that. And this all comes back to having clarity across all different types.
Thanks, Stephen. We've now got short supplementaries from Rachel Hamilton, then Beatrice.
I just wanted to ask Christopher Nicholson if he believes that the new entrance schemes and indeed the environmental schemes are too limited in scope. And obviously the budget has been cut in those schemes. Does that have an impact on how tenant farmers can look to the future?
It does, yeah. There's quite a bit of concern amongst our members about the future of agri-environment schemes, given that the tenanted sector tends to be concentrated in the more marginal areas. There was good uptake of those schemes amongst tenants, and unless you're in a designated area like a triple SI, there's no longer access to the agri-environment. In terms of new entrants, yes, that is funding that is being missed by new entrants. I think it's always a struggle for new entrants to find land to rent. Often land that does come up for rent, established farmers who landlords obviously or landowners see as a safer bet than an unknown new entrant. But the Scottish Lands Commission, I think, has had a really positive effect on encouraging some of the big landowners to let long-term to new entrants. And we're now seeing new entrants taking on 20-year leases, which is a very healthy sign, given that across the UK, short-termism is a major issue in the tenanted sector. I think the average length of a new lease in England is only 3 or 4 years now. And recently I looked at a list of farming opportunities to rent land in the UK, and the only ones that I could find over 10 years were all in Scotland. And I think that's the effect of encouraging landowners to take a long-term view rather than a short-term view. So while funding for new entrants is vital, if you're a new entrant, the big effect the Lands Commission can have on changing how land is let. I also think there's a bigger issue around the fiscal framework in which landlords operate. We've seen in Southern Ireland tax reforms or changes to the way income tax is treated around the letting of land has had an immediate effect in creating longer leases, which improves the productivity of the land. I think similar benefits could accrue in Scotland if we look at the fiscal framework around which tenants and landlords operate. Funding for new entrants is important, but there are other factors at play as well.
Thank you, Christopher. We'll move on to Beatrice.
Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Donald, you mentioned the Crofters Common Grazing and peatland restoration, but I wondered if you saw opportunities to expand woodlands on common grazings and also if you saw any barriers to doing so.
Yes, I think there are opportunities for expanding woodland on common grazings. I think since the Crofter Forestry Act in the 90s, crofters have in a way led the way on small woodland creation on their common grazings. I think we do have to be careful about what the land type is on these common grazings. I think we've seen in the past trees being planted in inappropriate locations on deep peat soils that would be much better maintained as peat, and in some cases restored and improved as peatland rather than being planted with trees. I think it's important that any forestry schemes going forward are suitable for crofters, that they can be taken forward by common grazings as a group of crofting shareholders, or that they are available at a scale that is suitable for individual crofters to take forward as part of their own crofting enterprise. So I think there are opportunities. I think it's important that the schemes are croft-proofed in a way, and that they do take acknowledgement of the unique set of circumstances that crofters find themselves in.
Thank you. I've got a final brief supplementary on this from Jim.
Thank you, convener. Is my light on? Yeah, it is. Sorry. This is probably more directed to Stephen and to Christopher. I had a question earlier on in my head about what are tenants' fears in relation to the support going into tree planting, peat restoration and stuff like that, and we've kind of skirted around about it. So I'd just like to understand the relationship between the landowner who may well be putting in the investment to plant trees while taking a support from the government to do so, and how that affects the tenant. And when I talk about tenants, I'm not just talking about pre-1999 tenants, I'm talking about people who have got long-term leases. Is there an equity of cost and funding that comes into the farm as a result of that? And how do you differentiate? Because if you've got a 20-year lease and the trees won't be harvested for 30 years, how is that going to work?
Who were you
addressing? So, Jessica, last question about a 20-year lease and the trees. To arrange an evaluation of those trees at the end of the 20-year lease, should the tenant be leaving. What we hope to see is that many of these 20-year leases are renewed to the same tenants or the successors. So evaluation might not come into it. What happens to tree planting at the end of a lease is something that needs to be addressed. There is a fear amongst tenants, and it's a genuine fear under the current legislation, that a tenant who does plant trees may be requested, should the lease come to an end, to reinstate it as agricultural land or face dilapidation claims due to the change of use of land. So those are areas that can be modified or amended in tenancy legislation. I also think the thrust of the forestry policy in Scotland is to create large blocks of commercial forestry as a means of achieving what are quite ambitious planting targets. I think it's 18,000 hectares a year. Given that there are about 50,000 farming businesses in Scotland, I think there's a huge opportunity that's being missed by not focusing on what individual farmers could do. If each of those farmers, or even if a quarter of those farmers planted small amenity plantations or small-scale commercial forestry on just an acre or two of their farm, it would go a long way towards meeting forestry targets, government forestry targets. It's difficult. The schemes that are available at the moment are very much focused on the bigger commercial scale. I know a lot of farmers who've tried to apply through Scottish Forestry to plant smaller areas on their farms, but have failed. And I think to integrate farming and forestry and for them to coexist, then the way forward is smaller blocks of forestry integrated with farmland rather than whole parishes disappearing under one block of commercial forestry. And certainly looking south of the border, there is more generous and easily accessible funding for smaller scale on-farm planting of trees. And I think there are farmers out there willing to give it a go, but they can't see a way forward at the moment. There are some good examples of people who've achieved it, but there's a lot of people who've become frustrated while trying to achieve small-scale on-farm plantations.
Okay, thank you very much.
So I think there are solutions there.
Thank you, Christopher. We'll now move on to questions on climate change and biodiversity loss from Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. This is I'm going to ask my questions all together. So I'll say them slowly so that you catch them. But so this is directed to Pete from Environment Link. So Pete, you mentioned at the beginning in your opening about a kind of keenness for the Good Food Nation Bill to be a framework bill against which to judge our future policies. And so what I'd like to know is what would you like to see in the Good Food Nation Bill to lay groundwork for a strong and coherent agricultural bill? So that's question number one. And a follow-up is that in your briefing paper, you had a recommendation that a proportion of farming support payments be redirected to local government. Is that something that you would like to see in the agricultural bill? And how much of the farm support budget would you recommend goes to local government? And can you give us some examples of how they could use that support to accelerate the transition to agroecological farming, healthy diets at a more local level? So that's for Pete. And then I've got a third question, which I think could be Pete. And I would like to bring in Miranda also on this, which is around potential announcements that the Scottish Government might make for new targets and commitments on farming to coincide with COP26. And I'd love to hear from both of you, and if we have time, other people, if they want to come in on this, what would you like those targets and commitments to include? So, Pete.
Thank you, Ariane. So, on the Good Food Nation Bill, certainly we want that to set a framework for food policy, which sets out really clearly what's the purpose of the food system in Scotland, what do we want to deliver. And at the core of that, it's healthy and sustainable diets for everyone, that everybody in Scotland can afford to enjoy a healthy and sustainable diet. And that means changing the way, the sort of food we're eating, less ultra-processed food, more local food, more unprocessed food, less sugar, a diet that actually meets our own dietary recommendations from the Food Standards Agency and other places. So everybody should be able to enjoy that in Scotland. And that then has implications for what we want our farmers to do to produce that diet. There are two things we're asking farmers to do when they produce food. One is to export it, and one is to feed the people of Scotland. And we need to get that balance right so that we're paying attention to feeding the people of Scotland well from our own resources. So that's the key thing. And we want the right to food to be at the heart of that bill, because that places obligations on government to ensure that everyone can eat well, to ensure that people can eat sustainably, and to ensure that the food system is joined up both nationally and at local level. We want to see an independent food commission, and we want to see some targets in the bill. But so there's brief answer to that. In terms of redirecting money to local government, I should emphasize this isn't a sort of collective link policy. Some members support, but we haven't bottomed everything out on this. But if you think of an example, improving public procurement of organic and local food, as happens in France, in Denmark, in lots of other member states, the EU, supporting local authorities to do that, to improve their procurement processes through a bit of the farm support money benefits farmers. It's not that money's being thrown away, but it's a very direct way to get money into the pockets of farmers who can produce food for local schools, food for hospitals, and so on. Similarly, we'd like to see a big focus on horticulture and urban and peri-urban horticulture, including a revival of the glasshouse sector in Scotland, which we lost in the 70s, but we could easily bring back. Now we have such an abundance of renewable energy that we could use. So a focus on horticulture, focus on urban farming, and a focus on lots of measures that can link producers to consumers and get short food chains in place. At the moment, a lot of farmers are sort of have to go through lots and lots of channels to get their food to market, and they're controlled by a very few large retailers, and that can really put farmers at a disadvantage, and it can also drive some of the food waste that we've seen recently, which is down to Brexit. You know, it's no mistake, and to some extent COVID, but to see huge amounts of produce going to waste, broccoli, cauliflower going to waste, when actually short food chains could have got that food to people who could have who could have bought it and eaten it. And then finally, before I hand over to Miranda on the things that we could do in terms of bold ambitions for COP26, we'd like to see bold commitments, like we said in the Farm 1.5 report, on methane reduction targets. There are technical measures that we can use to really drive that forward, but we have to adopt them at scale. Reducing nitrogen use in line with the Colombo Declaration and the Sustainable Development Goals, so we could halve nitrogen waste by 2030. We waste half the nitrogen we put on our land in Scotland. That just ends up in the water and in the air. It's a major pollutant. We need to tackle that. We think we could have a broader measure to reduce the global impact of the Scottish shopping basket. That's something which Tesco and WWF have adopted a few years ago and are actually making some progress on. The Co-op are also looking at reducing the impact. There's a lot of supply chain actors here who want to see these changes, and government could certainly support that. And we'd also like to see some bold action on organics. It's great that the SNP Greens Agreement and the Programme for Government have a strategy for organics and increasing the area of organic land. We think we could go further than that, and like other our European neighbours, put organic procurement targets into law so that we actually get our children in schools enjoying organic food, and organic food becoming something normal that kids eat every day, not something that is seen as sort of posh or out of reach for people. As Miranda said, agroecology is the way forward in this, and we need to find bold measures to support the transition to agroecology. Thank you.
And Miranda.
Yes, thank you. Yes, in terms of COP26, and I think this ties in to a lot of what Peter just said, we would like to possibly see a bit of an more integrated approach than that we have currently been. That includes both recognition of the value of whole farm approaches, that indeed includes organic, but it is also a bit broader than that. But also really understanding what the value of local food production can be in this regard. And we talk a lot here, but also in the context of agricultural reform, about farming practices and how we're going to adjust farming practices and land use on farms. But ultimately, the whole supply chain is responsible for a lot more emissions than just a farm. And this includes all kinds of things, transport, refrigeration, but also importantly, the footprint of inputs that go into farms. And I think we might not recognize enough the position that many farmers are in. They are sandwiched in many ways between, on one hand side, agri-input industries from seeds, machinery, pesticides, and on the other hand side, the commodity and supermarket. So there's only so much room to wriggle. So really, in the context of COP, recognizing that this is a whole supply chain approach and that there is real value in refocusing efforts on localized food production, genuinely local food production for community in the context of climate change mitigation.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Jenny Minto, or beg your pardon, Jim, have you got a supplementary on this question?
Yes. Thank you. Again, it's directed to Pete and to Miranda. We've got a bit of a problem in that food isn't cheap to produce, but it has to be cheap enough for people to be able to buy it. How do you square that?
Miranda, would you like to go first?
You go first. You and I have spoken.
It's obviously... a tricky question, but it also ties into a problem, a very systematic problem of the fact that cheap food isn't really cheap food. It's cheap food for the person who buys it in the supermarket, but it comes with huge externalities in terms of the environmental as well as the social costs involved. But that doesn't really give the solution. I would like to make the point that that we do see that some of our members who are working in tandem with both the environment and the community, providing huge environmental and social benefits, can do that at a reasonable price. And I would like to highlight the importance of those people in the supply of localized good food at decent prices during COVID, where a lot of the other systems failed, And I think we saw record numbers of people signing up to local pledge boxes where we could actually see that this can be done, but it's not necessarily an easy task. But yeah, it does require us to rethink the entire system, really think about, okay, what are we trying to achieve and how are we going to achieve it? And that it does mean redirecting some of the money, because at the moment, the suppliers of good produce with the least footprint are just not receiving the benefits in terms of both economies of skill, but also in terms of where public money is targeted to really be able to compete with a lot of others. And that's a shame. And I think there is a lot of scope, but it's just a difficult thing to do.
Thanks, Pete. And very briefly.
Good question, Jim. Start with a human rights-based approach and the right to food and make clear that over the next couple of decades, Scottish Government is going to take responsibility for addressing this issue so we move away from having a two-tier food system where so many people can't afford healthy, sustainable food. So Scottish Government is doing quite a lot with things like the child payment, and doubling that would again help, but that's focused on families with children who often, particularly single parents, are the most food insecure and the most worried about running out of money for food. Things like Best Start Foods, really positive too, in terms of increasing access to fruit and vegetables for the small people. But there are measures in other countries too, as well as these cash-based mechanisms, to link small-scale farmers, as Miranda said, specifically with low-income communities by facilitating market access for those farms and subsidising what they do in terms of public goods by providing nutritious food locally. So with the Glasgow Declaration coming to Glasgow, for COP26, we've got Sao Paulo coming to speak, and they have a massive program with organic farmers in and around the city providing that sustainable food locally, and the local government has got organized to make that happen. So there are things we can do to connect the farmers who want to nourish the people of Scotland, who want to get food into every household in Scotland that's safe, that's healthy, that's sustainable, and that's good for you and that's tasty, with the people who need that food. And this isn't an impossible problem to solve. But we've got a bit used to thinking there's no way of solving that problem. If we put our minds to it, we can afford to and manage nourishing everybody in Scotland well. Thanks.
Thank you, Pete. Very conscious we're running out of time. We've got two final questions. Karen and then Rachel.
Yeah, thank you. I had a little bit of a preamble before my question. I think Jim was looking at my notes. He stole my question, but I'm just going to go ahead and do this anyway. But it was more in regards to what Pete was discussing and answering to Ariane's questions. And we have quite a task to include environmental sustainability alongside health and dietary guidelines. And part of that is not allowing the importation of food produced to lower environmental standards than that we produce in Scotland, and not to simply discard the issue of environmental damage. We need to take the issue of poverty, diet, health and environment seriously as a package deal. We have a real problem of food insecurity and food poverty, and the Food Foundation estimates that the poorest decile of the population would have to spend 74% of their disposable income to eat, according to government guidelines, for a healthy diet, and eating, whereas that figure for the richest decile is just 6%. So it is quite a dilemma, and poverty doesn't just harm those living in it, also harms the local economy and the environment overall. I was going to ask, how can we square that, with the food growers and producers receiving a fair payment, but also supplying that food to people at an affordable price? So I'm hearing a lot about shortening the supply chain, and I was just wondering, within that, is there other packages of measures that we could really pin down on and hone in on? And if you could give your expertise on that we could take forward.
Thank you. Can we maybe ask that to Pete and then Stephen? So we're not hearing you.
With families themselves. But we're teasing that question out with families themselves, and we're listening to families about what is a healthy enough diet, what's a sustainable enough diet for them, and how can they afford that. So I think there's much more work to be done to really bottom out the gap, but it is substantial and it's serious. for at least 20% of our population, they really would struggle to eat a healthy, sustainable diet. They just couldn't afford what they know they'd like to be eating. And that's a real problem. Part of it is going to be cash measures, and the Scottish Government can only do what it can do, but it has made some progress on that. And part of it has to be food measures and really trying to reorient some of the food system so that we do get nutrition available to everybody. Free school meals, really important part of that. And there, I think there are other things we can do around the edge of that to improve access to fruit and vegetables in particular, but to unprocessed products and to make those affordable to people. But it does mean a rethinking of how we do food and not simply relying on the private sector to deliver the nutrition. It hasn't managed to do that up till now. We need to go into partnership with the private sector and say, okay, let's work together. Let's see how we can regulate the private sector to make sure that it's delivering more of what people need to eat and less of what people don't need to eat. But at the same time, how can we set up pricing mechanisms, but also income mechanisms? And the living wage, absolutely crucial in all this. Usdaw research showed that people who are part-time on a lower wage simply were much, much more likely to be food insecure than the people who are full-time, who are being paid a living wage. That gap, quite a small gap in the actual hourly rate, makes a huge difference to food insecurity. So we need to pay attention to wages and incomes, but we also need to look at how can we find other ways to shorten the food chains, make food more accessible to all of us. I don't think it's impossible. It's going to be tricky, and it's a long-term goal.
Thank you, Pete. And very briefly, Stephen.
Yeah, it was probably more on Jim's question a minute ago, but I agree with a lot of what Pete's saying about local food. I think as well, this links to trade as well. And I think one of the key things is really understanding the true cost of the high production and environmental standards we've got. And then once we've understood that, that's where the public goods funding can come in to fill that gap. But it all comes down to understanding the systems of production.
Thank you. Appreciate your brevity. And very finally, in the last minute, we've got Rachel, Women in Agriculture and Land-Based Industries.
The Scottish Government want to legislate for equal rights to succession for women in agriculture. I just wondered how your organisations promoted women in agriculture, considering that we do, as we listen to the last evidence, that we do have an issue with a cultural problem with bringing women into farming. And not only that, we have issues with access to land, finance, childcare, the responsibilities that women have. I'd like to start with Miranda.
Yes, thank you very much. And we absolutely agree that this is a very important topic. I mean, anecdotally, we are a small organization here in Scotland, but with a growing team on the ground, and we are all women. And it's difficult to say what that is because it's all agroecological, but to some degree, there is a lot of diversity in this sector. And we see that both in the way we run our organization as well as on the ground. And we are actually, in terms of diversity, focusing our efforts, notwithstanding that we do see that there are definitely members who deal with issues around succession and childcare, including myself, I'll be honest. But we are also looking at the wider scope of increasing diversity, including all gender identities, as well as looking to increase diversity of minority communities across the board. And it's not easy. I think it is really about, for us, it's about increasing the accessibility and visibility of the sector at places where it counts. And that means, for example, in schools at at all stages, primary schools, secondary schools, trying to get it into the minds that this is a place where people want to be.
Thank you, Miranda. Can I just quickly hear from Donald as well with regards to entrance into crofting, female entrance?
Thanks. I think Sally Shortall mentioned in the previous session that crofting has a slightly better story to tell on the involvement of women in the sector. I think we could do better. I don't think that there are any legislative barriers here, but I do think that some of my response to Alistair Allen's question earlier on about how we encourage new entrants into the sector in general,
I think that there would definitely be some benefits to women in that respect as well. And I think that it's something that needs urgent attention. And certainly we engaged with the Women in Agriculture Task Force and fully support their recommendations. Our board at the moment is 50-50, and we'll hope to maintain that going forward.
Thank you. And I think Stephen wished to come in on this for the last word.
Thank you. Apologies, my internet connection dropped there, so I'm not sure if I've missed anything. In terms of SLE, we are hugely supportive of the Women in Agriculture Task Force. Our Chief Executive, Sarah Jane Lang, sat on it. 50% of our senior management team is female and 30% of our board, and we're working to improve that. In terms of Women in Agriculture, I was a wee bit disappointed yesterday to see a QMS board have an all-male new intake of board members, and that's nothing against the individuals. I'm not sure if that sends the right message for a modern and progressive industry. I know Kate Rowell tried really hard to get more diverse applicants, but it's something we need to look at and try and improve. In terms of what we're doing, when we're recruiting onto our representative committees, we've changed the way that we do that. We've changed the wording, changed the language that we use, testimonials to try and encourage people to take part and get involved. And that is starting to kind of make a difference. So it's encouraging stronger voices. And I liked Sally Shortle's comment earlier on about not leaving your best players on the bench. Like, that's a huge part in this as well.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, Convener. Oh. It's a shame not to bring in the tenanted sector. Yes, absolutely. It's so important.
Women in tenancies.
Christopher.
Women in tenancies. Well, it's up to the landlords to let land to women. We have about 25% or a third of our board is made up of women at present, but I don't think that's representative of the tenancy sector as a whole. I think the number of women tenants as a percentage of total tenants will be a lot less than 25%. Most of the women tenants I know of, the farm was not originally let to a woman, but they have inherited the tenancy. I do notice a positive trend lately of some landlords letting to a couple rather than an individual, which recognises the importance that both partners have to play in the working of a family farm. And I think that's to be encouraged. But yes, I would like to see greater encouragement of women in the tenanted sector. There are some agriculture where women play their fair share. In particular, I'm thinking of the veterinary sector, which often have to do a lot of the hard work dealing with large animals. And if women can manage that without any problem, then I'm pretty sure they can manage the rest of farming without much. I think there are barriers to do with custom and legislation around succession. True, there's nothing stopping someone leaving all their land to a daughter or a son, but equally there's nothing preventing a land bequeathing all his land to a son instead of a daughter. So I suspect there's a bit of culture, custom and legislation that needs to be looked at. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And the session's run over by 5 minutes. I'm quite sure the Cabinet Secretary won't mind waiting 5 minutes as we got your views on such an important topic. So once again, thank you for your contributions today. We will now very briefly suspend the session to allow a changeover in witnesses. Thank you. We now move to agenda item 2, and the committee will now take evidence on the Animal Welfare Licensing of Activities Involving Animals, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. And these regulations are subject to the affirmative procedure and refer members to paper 2. I welcome Mary Gujon, Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, and her officials, John Nicholson, Policy Manager for Animal Welfare Team, and Grant McClarty, the Solicitor. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener, and I'm happy to appear before the committee today to discuss the amending instrument, which makes some minor amendments to the 2021 licensing regulations that were approved by the Scottish Parliament in February this year and which came into force on the 1st of September. Now, as the amendments proposed aren't contentious and they're limited both in terms of their impact and their scope, I want to keep my opening remarks brief. But the amendments being considered today amend the conditions which are applicable to 2 out of the 6 licence types available under the 2021 licensing regulations. And that's namely animal rehoming licences and animal welfare establishment licences. The other types of licence are unaffected. Now, the change that's specific to animal rehoming activities is the removal of the prohibition on the supply of kittens, so that's cats under 6 months old, as pets if they are not bred by the licence holder. Now, this change will permit persons who hold a licence to engage in animal rehoming activities, including foster carers working with animal welfare charities to rehome kittens. Now, the need for this change was brought to the attention of the Scottish Government during discussions with Cats Protection on the development of detailed guidance for local authorities. Given the significant issues with the unlicensed puppy trade, we don't propose to remove the corresponding prohibition on the supply of puppies, which applies to holders of a licence to engage in animal rehoming activities, as to do so would no doubt encourage those involved in that cruel trade to attempt to use animal rehoming as a cover for their unlicensed breeding and dealing activities. But stakeholders also brought to our attention during discussions on the development of local authority guidance that there would be merit in mirroring certain safeguards included in the conditions applicable to rehoming activities in those that apply to animal welfare establishments. So accordingly, these amending regulations will prohibit holders of a licence to operate an animal welfare establishment from supplying unweaned mammals, mammals weaned at an age at which they should not have been weaned, non-mammals that are incapable of feeding themselves, and puppies, kittens, ferrets and rabbits aged under 8 weeks. So while it's very unlikely that a holder of an animal welfare establishment licence would actually supply such an animal, we've agreed that the inclusion of these additional conditions is appropriate and merited as it further safeguards the welfare of particularly vulnerable animals. I hope the committee will agree that although the changes we seek to make to the 2021 regulations are relatively minor in nature, they are important because they remove a restriction which has potential to impact on the rehoming activities of Cats Protection, given their routine use of foster homes as part of their rehoming activities. And they also bring forward some additional protections for particularly vulnerable animals under the care of those operating animal welfare establishments. And with that, I'd be happy to take any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I'm delighted that the first piece of legislation this committee is dealing with is kittens. But as you say, it may be minor, but it is nonetheless very important when it comes to animal welfare. Would any members have any questions? Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, OneKind and Cat Protection have raised the possibility that this amendment may enable rehoming to be used as a cover for illegal kitten trade. Will any measures be put in place to monitor this situation and ensure that illegal kitten trading does not increase as a result?
I thank the member for raising that concern, but I would say that we're only proposing this amendment because it came to light through discussions with Cats Protection as we were developing the guidance for local authorities. And we didn't have any objections to providing this amendment to the regulations. But of course, when it comes to monitoring, we want to make sure that there aren't any adverse impacts to that. We're in regular engagement with animal welfare stakeholders and with other organisations too. So we would be in close contact and if there were any issues that came to light. But certainly, from what we proposed so far and from discussions with Cats Protection and other animal welfare stakeholders, this is an amendment that has been welcomed.
Thank you.
Jenny Minto.
Just a very quick question, just widening out on Ariane Burgess's question about the level of consultation and who the consultation was with. Thanks.
In relation to this amendment, there was obviously a consultation undertaken when we were introducing the licensing regulations, it was only some of the issues that we're looking to address today only came to light when we were developing the guidance for local authorities and working with our animal welfare stakeholders. So we've been working closely with them throughout this process and in developing that guidance, and that's why we're bringing this forward today to address that. So while there wasn't any formal consultation, as I say, we're in close engagement all the time so that we can identify these issues and address them.
Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, the amendment doesn't appear to do anything to halt the trading up of kittens, which often happens when individual kittens are offered for sale on the internet. They're resold then at a higher price, with people posing as the owners of the parents of the cats. So, and as if they've bred the kittens. Does the Cabinet Secretary foresee any further amendments to the licence regulations to clamp down on this form of trading?
I mean, again, this is something that we would closely monitor, but I would say that the licensing regulations that we introduced and which came into force on the 1st of September really modernised the whole licensing system that we have. It made it more robust as well. So I think that we've gone a long way in terms of trying to tackle some of the issues that have been experienced. But of course, this is something that we will continue to monitor. And as I said in previous responses, we're in close engagement with animal welfare stakeholders, and that's continuous. So if there are other issues that emerge that we need to consider, then we will, of course, look to do that.
Rachel Hamilton.
Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us how you will be monitoring this system and looking at, you know, the question that Finlay Carson's just asked you, because if animals aren't chipped, then it means that there is a possibility that they could be traded on further, and this that this happen in terms of that upselling.
I mean, well, like I say, we have proposed these amendments through the engagement that we've had with our animal welfare stakeholders in developing the detailed guidance for local authorities. We work closely with the likes of the SSPCA, so we've worked with them in developing and training and a toolkit that can be used as well. So again, this is something that, of course, we will closely monitor. We're in regular engagement with the likes of the SSPCA, with Cats Protection, with other animal welfare charities and organisations. So, of course, through that regular engagement, we will pick up on any issues that are there as well. We also have the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, which deals with particular issues too. So I would really just want to assure members and to assure the committee that when it comes to this, we're in close contact with all regulars, with all of our stakeholders, in the hope that we can pick up any early issues, if there are any that emerge through this process. But again, I would come back to the point that the licensing regulations that we introduced, the amendments that we're proposing today, have been welcomed by those stakeholders.
Thank you. Any members have any further questions? No? OK, we'll move to agenda item 3, where we move on to the formal consideration of the motion to approve animal welfare licensing of activities involving animals, Scotland Amendment Regulation 2021. I invite Ms Gujan to move the motion. Motion S6M00997, that the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee recommends that the Animal Welfare Licensing of Activities Involving Animals Scotland Amendment Regulation 2021 be approved. Does any member have a wish to debate the motion? If so, is the committee content to recommend approval of this instrument? Agreed. Finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a report on our deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary and our officials for attending today. We now move into private session.